Welcome, hockey fans, to Pass Sports, presentation of the Ontario Hockey League this afternoon, live from Detroit's Joe Louis Arena. The Detroit Junior Red Wings play host to the Sudbury Wolves. Good afternoon, everyone. Dave Strader along with Mickey Redmond as this work stoppage in the National Hockey League continues. We continue to try to bring you the best hockey that is available, and we've got a couple of first-place teams in the OHL. And let's take a look at the standings to familiarize you with the makeup of the OHL. There are three divisions. The two division leaders we have, of course, the Detroit Junior Red Wings, coming off a couple of victories Friday night in London, 7-1, 5-3 here last night against Guelph. They lead their division, as you see, with a 10-3 record. The Sudbury Wolves are also a team in first place over in the Central Division with a 9-3-1 record for 19 points. Detroit is playing their third game in 2.5 days. Sudbury playing their third game in 3.5 days. And a graduate of the OHL himself, or maybe the OHA, it was known in those days, the Peterborough Petes, Mickey Redmond. And Mick, we had an opportunity to do a couple of Michigan games here on PASS last weekend. We watched the game here last night between the Junior Red Wings and the Guelph Storm. Your assessment of the difference in the styles of the two games?
Well, the biggest thing I think that I noticed is the hockey sticks were not up as much last night as they were last weekend in the college games. And, of course, I think the main reason for that is that the college players are wearing the full mask. Most of them have the screen, not the shield. OHL players, strangely enough, interestingly enough, they all have a half a shield on. They have the option to wear a full mask. Nobody in the OHL wears a full mask, so can draw what conclusion you want from that, but I did notice the sticks were much more down last night than they were last weekend, and that's good to see.
Paul Maurice is the head coach of the Junior Wings, and he had this to say about his team's preparation for the game this afternoon.
Well, it's important we get out the gate to a good start and establish our forechecking game, make the simple plays in our end of the ice. The Sudbury Wolves have good speed up front and some good size on defense. They like to clog up the middle of the ice, so we're going to need to get the puck in deep and use their speed to the outside.
Well, as you might expect, with not a lot of NHL or no NHL hockey being played, there were quite a few NHL scouts in attendance last night, and again here this afternoon. We expect to see more. And the guy that everybody seems to be talking about, where's number 34 for the Junior Red Wings? A defenseman, but boy, can he get up on the offense, Brian Berard.
He sure can. 17 years old, this kid. He has not been drafted yet. And, of course, that's going to come up next June in the summertime somewhere, and if and when everything gets back on track in the NHL. This kid is an offensive-type player. I talked to him a few minutes before coming upstairs, and we are going to chat with this young man if everything goes well for us in the second intermission. But keep your eye on him. Very cool for a 17-year-old. Got a one or two steps ahead mentally than other guys on the ice, as we saw it last night.
A guy up front he'll be trying to get the puck to is Matt Ball, a kid that was drafted last June by Jimmy Rutherford, of course, connected with the CompuWare organization, scoring a goal a game.
He's playing very well, got a great set of hands. That's the thing you'll notice about this kid. And I think one of the interesting things is Coach Maurice said to us, he came in here last year about 18, 20 pounds overweight. He's dropped that weight now, but he's got an excellent set of hands, knows where to put the puck, obviously, with a goal a game going right now.
Old friend of mine, Glenn Murkowski, who is the only player to have his number retired in Glens Falls with the Adirondack Red Wings, is the general manager and coach of the Sudbury Wolves. We talked about his team a little bit before the game this afternoon. Basically, goaltending, defense, goals against. They're a very solid team. But the first guy we're going to look at is a defenseman who was the OHL Defenseman of the Year, and he did it, Mick, putting up some great offensive numbers, Jamie Rivers.
Well, Rivers is a guy that Glenn Murkowski goes to quarterback his power play, if you will. He's a big, tall kid, likes to move the puck. He's only got one goal, but leads the overall team with 17 assists, as you see there. Likes to make the play, obviously. And whenever you've got a quarterback for your offense, getting it started out of your own zone, that's a big advantage for your forwards.
Kid by the name of Zdeněk Nedved. Now, Nedved's a familiar name to NHL fans. Apparently no relation to Peter Nedved, but he is related in terms of his ability to do things offensively.
Yeah, he is. He had over 50 goals last year. He has been drafted already by the Toronto Maple Leafs in the third round last year. And as is the case from time to time, maybe too much for not, for a lot of people in hockey, this kid is having a problem getting motivated. He signed a three-year deal with the Leafs. He's only got 7 goals so far. Obviously, he's better than that. But watching him in the warm-up here, he does have the ability to play the game. You can see the way he handles the puck. But again, with that 18-year-old draft and those big contracts, I guess the Leafs have already spoken to him and said, hey, come on, we're going to be playing hockey not too far away. We want you doing the job we know you can do.
Well, we hope you all consider this the first treat of your Halloween weekend as we have OHL action. The Junior Red Wings playing host to the Sudbury Wolves next live right here on PASS. The Junior Red Wings on Pass Sports is brought to you in part by the Wellness Plan, an HMO that's good for you. By Little Caesars, where you always get two great pizzas for one low price. And by the Discover Card. It pays to discover the card that pays you back. Already has his Halloween costume picked out. Coming to the Joe Louis Arena here this afternoon as a hockey player. Had a little bit of the blood in the corner of his mouth, the black guy, the Red Wing jersey. Good afternoon, everyone. Dave Strader back along with Mickey Redmond, and we're glad that you're with us here on this beautiful autumn afternoon, late October. It's still golf weather outside, and it may be tough to think about hockey for some people, but I think, Mick, given the ongoing problems in the NHL, I think a lot of people are glad to welcome the sight of a rink and hockey being played at whatever level it might be. And if there is one upside perhaps to all of this problem in the NHL, there is more exposure for leagues like the OHL and some of the other minor leagues. We're going to be doing an Adirondack game in a couple of weeks down in Glens Falls to see the top farm team of the Detroit Red Wings, the Adirondack Red Wings. But I know these kids for the Junior Red Wings are excited, although they're playing their third game in less than three nights, they're excited about the exposure they'll get here on Pass Sports.
Well, they're young. They've got lots of energy. I'm sure that they're going to be just fine, even though they are playing their third game and their third day, Friday night, Saturday night, and this afternoon, and played a couple of pretty good hockey clubs last night against Guelph. They won 5-3 with an empty net goal. And this Sudbury team, as we talked about in the open, leading their division of the OHL, an experienced hockey club, quick skating team, led by their goaltender, Mullen, who is an overaged player. And Detroit's Paul Morris also banks on his goaltending an awful lot as well. So keep your eye on those two guys at either end as we have our national anthem.
Our home and native land. True patriot love in all thy sons command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise the true north, strong and free. From far and wide, oh Canada, we stand on glorious and free. Oh Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
Take a look at the goaltenders for the game here this afternoon. As Mick already mentioned, an overage player, meaning he is 20 years of age. OHL teams are allowed to have two overage players and also two 16-year-olds on their team. So Matt Mullen, an experienced guy, and he has played exceptionally well, as you can tell by the numbers. I love the look of the Wolves head there on the front of the Sudbury jersey. And Jason Saul, as you can see, he's been the primary goalkeeper for Paul Maurice and the Junior Red Wings, although an excellent performance last night by Aaron Ellis in goal. But Saul gets the nod here this afternoon with his 8-2 mark. As you look at the officials working the game, Mark Hicks is the referee. Scott Hoberg and Don Klein are the linesmen. And we'll also see, as we take a look at Paul Maurice behind the junior Red Wing bench, that this game, in terms of the rules, more closely resembles the NHL game. The red line is in there for the two-line pass as well as the icing rule. And you have to see the odd scrap, I think, in these games more so than in the college game. And Mr. Mullen, the Sudbury goaltender, obviously needs a new piece of lumber. He slides his goal stick over to the bench.
Well, the big difference there with the mask, or not mask, or the half mask, if you will, and fighting in the game is in college you're kicked out. And in the OHL, you go to the penalty box, like the NHL. No automatic icing.
Maurice going with his line of Tom Buckley, along with Sheehan and Mitchell. This was basically their number three line last night. They've got a couple of lines that can really go offensively. The one thing that Glenn Murkowski, the coach and general manager of Sudbury, told me was that his club is not as quick as the junior Red Wings. And whether the scheduling, with both teams playing their third game in about as many days, will have an effect. We'll have to wait and see. Buckley is run into by Rivers, number eight. Puck came out to center ice, and it's driven back into the Sudbury zone by Quade Lightbody, number two for the junior Wings. As both teams start to make changes, Sudbury's number 24, Gary Kupel, just dumped it out to center ice, and the junior Wings dumped it back in. Frappier quickly working it back. Kupel, center ice, dumps it along the boards. In behind, Jason Saul, the goaltender for the junior Wings. Haggerty, who had a heck of a game last night, lost the puck. And a quick scoring opportunity there for number 18, Barry Moore, who has 9 goals in the early part of this OHL season.
Maybe their best hockey player so far this year, Barry Moore.
There's a chance now for the junior Wings, but the pass for Haggerty a bit behind him. A much better crowd here this afternoon than we had last night. Here's Berardt with the steal. He moves in, looking to center, but pretty good defensive recovery by Nedved. A turnover here. Quick shot fired over top of the net. And McCauley, number 19, was right at the top of the crease looking for that hard redirection off the end boards. And the goaltender, Matt Mullen, was just quick enough to get his glove over that loose puck.
There's the young man we highlighted on the open, Brian Berardt, who will be my guest in the second intermission. Started that offensive play. He was out of Woonsocket, Rhode Island. Came right out of high school, although he did have some experience at all-star teams and some international play, etc., on his way up, just 17 years old. And of course, he'll be looking forward to being drafted by an NHL team next June.
Here's one of those two offensive lines I was talking about now, as ball number 11 comes out with Blair 22, Sika 24 for the junior Red Wings. Delayed offside here, and they wave it off. Gagne, number 17 for the Wolves, center ice, works it across the junior Wings blue line. A centering pass there off a skate, and Blair able to roll it ahead to ball he was unable to control. Mike Wilson, number 5 for the Sudbury Wolves, 6'6", 200-pound defenseman. This is a big defense for the Sudbury Wolves. Interesting to see how the size of Sudbury's defense does against the speed of the junior Wings. Icing here indicated as number 7, LaCour, goes back to touch for the junior Red Wings.
6'6", 19 years old. What the heck's he going to be when he grows up? I'll tell you.
Glenn Murkowski, his third year with Sudbury. His first year as general manager and coach. Sam McMaster was the general manager of this Sudbury organization and, of course, took the job with the LA Kings. So Glenn said, I basically inherited the general manager's role, but he really has enjoyed working with the young kids. He said there's so much involved with the junior programs. He said we have to interview all the prospective homes where the kids are going to live, try to take care of these kids' schooling, and he said it's as much babysitting as it is worrying about the hockey end of it.
Schooling very, very important for most of these, if not all of these junior teams and the kids. Paul Maurice said that the parents, first question, what about the schooling? Where are they going to go? How tough are you on them? What kind of demands do you have?
Saul was able to clear that out of the crease, and the junior Wings started back as Mitchell dumps it to the right of the Sudbury goal. Now Sheehan lays it along the end boards. Mitchell there again gets a stick on it. Now Sheehan has a man open out in front. Buckley had just missed him with the centering pass. going to have a penalty coming here. It looked like a hit by the junior Red Wing player that was heading to the bench. There's the touch up. I think it was Mitchell. He was frustrated about something that had happened in front of the Sudbury net, and as he was on his way to the bench, right in front of the referee Hicks, he put a lick on one of the Sudbury players, and Sudbury Mick will get a power play opportunity.
It may have been Nedved because he gave him the stick as the whistle was going.
Interference, the call on number 27, Jeff Mitchell, a 19-year-old out of Wayne, Michigan. Several local products on this junior Red Wing team.
There was Nedved giving a shot to one of the Red Wing players, but that happened just as the whistle was going outside the line.
Here's a chance for Allison, who drives the shot just wide. Rivers, rather, number 8. He sends it across now. Fitzpatrick's shot deflected off the stick of Berard. The Wolves with the power play opportunity. No score in the hockey game. Just 3.5 minutes gone by. Rivers is the guy they look to set up, as Mick pointed out at the top of the show. He leads the Sudbury Wolves in scoring. He has just one goal. But 17 assists as the junior wing's able to clear. And Rivers again headmans it. Snap it across now for Gagne. Gagne ridden into the end boards by McCauley. Berard bangs it off the glass, held in by Rivers. They get it back out to the right point, and a drive there by Fitzpatrick, steered aside by Saul. Fitzpatrick, the captain of the Sudbury club. Another defenseman with excellent size, 6'2", 205, a draft pick of the Montreal Canadiens. Here's another opportunity for Rivers. It's on the netting, and the referee indicates the faceoff outside the zone.
Sudbury moved the puck pretty well with the extra man. They're a team with a few more experienced players in the junior ranks, and that certainly pays off, especially when you're on the road. A little more cool under fire. Good stop there by Saul.
Seconds left in the penalty. Mitchell of the junior wing. Now Rosinski clearing around the boards and out. It's driven down the ice by number 22, Scott Blair, out of Allen Park, Michigan. Rochefort, number 19 for the Wolves, drives it around the boards to the junior wing zone. Ball able to get to it for Detroit. He clears it back into the Sudbury zone. Mullen directing traffic as the defenseman Fitzpatrick gets back. Fitzpatrick sends it ahead, just 10 seconds left of the Sudbury power play. Rochefort got there about the same time as Lightbody. Wolves hold it in. Here's another chance for Rivers, steered aside. Nedved with a shot, that hit the post. You can hear it clang all the way up here as the penalty to Mitchell has expired. And the junior wings looking to break here, and they just missed the pass intended for Buckley. And Rivers will go for a change. He played just about every second of that power play, if not all of it. Centering attempt here by the Wolves, and Buckley, good recovery. Penalty coming up against Sudbury, I believe. And there's the whistle on the touch-up by the defenseman, Jay McKee. So the junior wing, in a scoreless game, have killed off a Sudbury power play, and they'll have a power play of their own right after this. Sudbury penalty goes to number 18, Barry Moore, for slashing. So the junior Red Wings get the power play opportunity, and Paul Maurice comes out with McCauley between Haggerty and Ball, with Berard and Harmer back at the points. Last night in the 5-3 victory over Guelph, the junior Wings were outshot 29-20. Mentioned that Aaron Ellis, who played a goal for the junior Wings, had an excellent game. Junior Wings just took advantage of the opportunities that were given to them. Harmer's shot from the point was deflected off of Benedam, number 12 for Sudbury. Here's McCauley out to the right point. Berard over there. Haggerty goes to the front of the net. There's number 91, like another very familiar player in a Red Wing uniform for the Detroit Red Wings. Of course, Sergei Fedorov. Up there, yep.
No question about that. Miscue at the point. by the junior wings. If they could have had the puck in, they overskated it. Sudbury got a hold of it. And then a trip at center ice, it's unnecessary. In a shorthanded situation, here's the miscue, and away he goes. And the hook on the right knee, and four aside we go for a minute and 20 seconds if nothing else develops.
Well, we showed you the standings at the top of the show for the Central Division, where Sudbury leads, Guelph, Kitchener, Niagara Falls, Owen Sound are the other cities of the Central Division, Detroit leading the West. You have Winter, of course, right across the river. Oddly enough, though, talking to the Junior Red Wing people last night, they said Sault Ste. Marie is their big rivalry. You would think that it might be Windsor right across the river. Of course, the Sarnia team that is owned by partially by Dino Cicerelli and Sean Burr. Sarnia Sting also in the West Division. Four skaters aside, Buckley centering pass. Mitchell gets there, got the shot away, hit the base of the post. They worked that well. And the Wolves unable to complete the pass the other way.
One part of the game right there that Rivers is going to have to work on defensively.
That's one of the things that Glenn Murkowski talked about with Rivers coming off a 120-point season and defenseman of the year. He really doesn't have to prove anything else offensively, and he's really trying to work on the other areas of the game. Trappier, number seven for the Sudbury Wolves. Working alongside Rivers. Trappier takes a bump there from Blair as it goes in behind the Detroit net. Moore will come out of the box for Sudbury in about 15 seconds. Crowd thought there should have been a penalty. Referee Hicks had a good look at it, decided no infraction. 5 seconds before Moore comes out to give Sudbury another power play. Sudbury has registered 4 shots on goal. The junior wings have been credited with just one, and another power play here, but it's a shorthanded opportunity. Mitchell snaps the shot. And that was dipping as it was heading toward the goaltender Mullen. Rather, that was Blair 22 that got the shot away. And Fitzpatrick from behind the Sudbury net will lug it ahead with 20 seconds left in the Harmer penalty. No score in the hockey game. 12:05 remaining here in the first period. Dave Strader along with Mickey Redmond, and we hope to visit with Executive Vice President Jim Devolano of the Detroit Red Wings in our first intermission as Berard carries it ahead into the Sudbury zone, and it was McCauley, number 19, that was just unable to hold up. What a night number 19 had for the junior wings last night. Bill McCauley, a goal and 3 assists. Selected as the number one star of the game. Another local kid, McCauley, out of Warren, Michigan, 19 years of age, 6'1", 195 pounds. And as you mentioned, Mick, these kids, mostly 17, 18, 19, and most of them 6 foot, 6 foot one, and in the 190 to 200 pound range, and of course still growing. Big hit on the Sudbury defenseman Trappier there by Mitchell. Now out at the point, a shot by LaCour did not get through. Mitchell holding off the Sudbury player Trappier, then Trappier went down, tried to clear. Buckley gets a stick on it. Well, the Wolves recover, send it to center ice. Harmer drives it back in. Trappier there to easily clear it off the boards, and immediately the icing waved off, so Harmer is going to have to move it. He's got two Wolves coming in, a big hit put on him, and it's going to be a penalty. No?
Nice
yeah,
stick.
There is, yeah.
Puck was caught with a high stick.
Puck was hit with a high stick, yeah, right?
By the junior wings, so the faceoff comes back inside the blue line. No score in the hockey game. We played inside 9 minutes, rather, of the first period. 3 games in 3 nights for the junior wings. I would expect that they will be changing much quicker than normal. Even though they are young guys and have lots of energy, that's a lot to ask out of your physical body to go 3 games. And these kids play physical hockey.
Interesting you mentioned that the players in the OHL have the option to wear the full mask, and Nobody right now is exercising that option. And
they all have a half mask on.
The unfortunate mishap in the Quebec Junior League not too long ago where a young kid lost his eye. It was a rather freak accident on a play that happens quite a bit. A player come up from behind, tried to lift a stick, and the stick actually deflected off the inside of the shield, and the blade of the stick cut the eye, and he lost his eye. Sika starts it back for the junior wings. Gave it off to Ball, who pushed it to the corner. Sika, another kid. Good size, 6'1", 190-pounder. From Sundridge, Ontario. A lot of the small towns, Mick, that I'm sure you're familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
There's a chance to flare, just out of his reach. We have the open net there for a moment with Mullen down. A centering attempt here for Ball cutting for the net. Junior wing with great pressure. Here's a shot from the point. And it's the player again.
What a stop. Back to back save by Mullen. When
Mullen
we see that one
on
again.
His back. There's going to be a penalty here, I believe, against number two, Jay McKee. The Blair, like half of the first time, couldn't get a real good pop the second time around, but his third crack at it, Mick, I think might have hit the inside of Mullen's leg as he was on his back and throwing his skates in the air.
The first stop holding penalty, as see Hicks with the signal there, but the first stop was a good one. The second one was a great one. I believe with the right pad of Mullen, as Blair did get it up. Take a look at it. The shot came through at the point, a bit of a knuckleball with nothing on it. That was the first opportunity by Blair that he couldn't quite reach. Had Mullen going to the right, and he's taken out of the play. Here is the one that Mullen made a couple of stops. Right here with the low pad, and right here again. The puck bounced up in the air and out to the defenseman.
I think he might have gotten that one with the low pad as well, as we looked at it on that replay.
They make no excuses about what they do. Here's Rivers that we talked about on the open. Looked like he banged up a leg. That Mullen's the key to the Sudbury team if they're to go a long way in the playoffs and challenge for the Memorial Cup. And Mullen's going to be the guy to get them there.
So the junior wings with their second power play. Their first one lasted only about 20 seconds when they took a subsequent minor themselves, as we've just reached the halfway mark of the first period. Still no score in the hockey game. Sudbury out shooting the junior wings 5-2. Minute and a half left in the Jay McKee penalty, who went off for holding at 9:42. Berard will send it ahead center ice. Harmer dumps it to the corner. Mullen started to come out. Now Fitzpatrick fanned on it, but teammate there to back him up. Failed to clear. Shot by Berard. Wide of the net. Now Harmer again. Rolls it in behind the Sudbury goal. Here's McCauley. He'll drop it back. Berard at the left point. Takes a look. Dumps it toward the net. Redirected and in the glove of Mullen. He hangs on.
Detroit not really getting an open pop at Mullen here. They're jamming the front of the net. You see Berard, who, like Rivers on the other side, quarterbacks the power play. A couple of junior wings go to the front of the net. But Sudbury, an experienced team that they are. Fitzpatrick, the captain, number four, staying right home and clearing the front of the net and letting Mullen handle the puck. There is nothing and no substitute for excellent goaltending. What an advantage.
Berard out at the left point, always with his head up, gives it off to Harmer, drives the shot, follows the save, loose puck between the circles, driven to the boards. Harmer will hold it in, 45 seconds left. And the penalty to McKee of Sudbury. Now Ball and McCauley working the end boards. McCauley has it out to the right point. Harmer, one timer redirected, wide of the net. Junior wing set it up again. Nice cross-ice pass. Berard gets one man down, still has it. Tried to roll in front, lost control. Gets it back, and then the intercept, and look out here. Sudbury with a chance to break. They get it ahead to Rochefort. He fakes the shot, now gets it away, and he tried to slide it back to Saul's right as the goaltender had to move to his left. Drop pass McCauley for Haggerty. Haggerty bumped down the boards, and the puck cleared by Rochefort. Penalty to Jay McKee has expired, and Sudbury back in full strength with 8:15 now remaining here in the first period. No score. Crowd just loves the hitting. Centering pass, light body, a chance here, and it hit the defenseman in front. Number six, Neil Martin, and Mullen never had to make the save. A shot from the far circle, no, a fake. And McCauley tried to go back to the point. He's dumped to the ice, and Gagne starts it back for Sudbury. Poked away by Harmer. Here is Ball. He thought he might have McCauley with him. He's going to the bench. Ball, nice move. Wraparound opportunity. Mullen has it covered. No whistle yet. And the Wolves finally do get it to center ice. 3-on-3 into the junior wing zone. Saul forced to make a save there as it comes up the left wing side out of the reach of Sika, and Mike Wilson gets it to his teammates, and they flip it deep into the Detroit zone. 7:20 left in the first. Dangerous move there by Mitchell, but he found enough room to get through. Number two, the defenseman Jay McKee for Sudbury without a stick, but he finds enough time to get over to the bench and get a new one. Really a miscommunication there between Saul and Lightbody. Now the puck held in by Wilson of Sudbury. His shot blocked by Buckley. And McKee drove it off the stick of Mitchell up into the crowd out of play. 6:55 remaining here in the first period of the Joe Louis Arena. No score. 6:55 left in the first period. No score. Sudbury and Detroit. Now the shots are 5 apiece. Maybe both teams are showing a little bit of the effects of playing the 3 games so close together.
Playing a little bit scrappy there the last couple of shifts. The center ice area, a lot of guys colliding in the mid area, and a lot of completed passes. Look out here, ball's around.
He's got a 2-on-1 ball looking for Blair. The pass off the defenseman, the puck behind the net. They get it in front of Blair. And may have just fired it wide. Another opportunity right in the crease, and Mullen has it covered. Blair was there. He takes a shot in the back.
Boy, Blair's had a bushel full of opportunities here in the first period already. You can see easily why they talk about the goaltender Mullen the way they do. 2-on-1, good defensive play right there. Defenseman is supposed to take the pass away on a 2-on-1. He did it. And maybe Ball might have telegraphed it just a little bit.
What would happen here? I might hit the base of the post.
Yeah.
Mullen was over there, though, stretched out. Get a better idea from our overhead angle. We have Blair ready to
outside of the post.
Yep. Take a pop at it. And Ball with a goal and an assist last night in the victory over Guelph. Mentioned the crowd here this afternoon. Apparently, the Junior Red Wings are quite involved with the DARE program, among other community activities. And through the DARE program, a lot of tickets were given out. Good turnout here this afternoon. Like about 8,000 or 9,000. Benedam for the Wolves, sent it back to the Detroit line. Down to 6:25 remaining in the first. Scoreless hockey game. Both teams have had a couple of power play opportunities that have gone by the board. Now here's Blair sliding it in front, and Ball just couldn't get the stick on it to redirect it. Blair again in the corner. Ball along the end board. Of course, Sudbury had their top scorer, their offensive defenseman, taken off the ice. Number 8, Jamie Rivers. We'll try to get you an update on the status of his injury. As Ryan Shanahan starts it back now for Sudbury. Cross ice, and one of the Sudbury players, Benedam, fell down. And Ball able to wrist it into the Sudbury zone. A collision back there, Fitzpatrick. Big kid, number 13, Mike Maroney, a tough kid. Picked up from Owen Sound. Did not skate a shift last night, but he's got his first shift here this afternoon. Look out, Harmer had it in his feet, couldn't find it. Haggerty clears it down. Buckley with a burst of speed, but the defenseman McKee had a head start on him. McKee taking it into the boards, and there's going to be a penalty.
Yeah. Maybe for interference or holding. Almost like an offensive interference call here. And Sudbury will go back to the power play. They aren't done yet. Outside of the, you look at the uniforms of the junior clubs, like the college teams, a real different look than the NHL teams. Of course, Detroit, the same as the Red Wings. There's a look at the play that caused the penalty. No question about that. As McCauley's got the hold and the hook and the grab and everything else. And
we're happy to say that it's close to Halloween, so these guys have an excuse.
If they
showed up that way in November or December, we might question what's going on. But
guys are girls.
Well, I think you're right. It was going to be a power play, but they
nullified.
Yeah, McKee came back and gave it back to McCauley. Okay. So the penalty's coming here at 14:42 of the first period. 2 minutes each. Craig Hartsburg, who of course played a long time for the Minnesota North Stars. Last night in with Guelph, the coach. Greg Steffen, former goaltender for the Red Wings and assistant coach with the Junior Wings. And you're right, a lot of scouts here. Now, a lot of scouts would be here anyway, here and right. The college games.
Here's Berard with an opportunity. Mick that hit a teammate, Mitchell, in front.
But the difference you're seeing now is you're seeing a lot of coaches and general managers of the NHL teams at these games, and they wouldn't normally have the time to do that. Remember a week ago, Scotty Bowman said sometimes it's difficult. You don't have the time to go and see players. You have to depend on your scouting staff, and you draft people that you really may have only seen once or twice. And general managers like to see themselves, the players that they're going to gamble on and draft.
Now, one of the things we might be able to talk about with Jim Devolano in the first intermission is what happens if this situation continues in the NHL. Ooh. Great stop there by Mullen on Berard. If the season is lost, will there be a draft in 1995? So many issues that are involved in this whole thing that it's hard to put it all together. Here's Berard. Ooh, oh boy, wow. He took a hip check there.
He sure did.
Harmer continued on, tried to move it to Haggerty. It's intercepted, and back the other way, Neil Martin, the defenseman number 6, leading a rush for Sudbury, has a teammate in front. The redirection fired wide. Good opportunity there for number 18, Moore. Now Newhook sends it across, shot from the slot by Martin was blocked, and Berard just lifting it out of trouble. As we're under 4 minutes left in the first period now, and a half a minute left in the coincidental minors to McCauley of Detroit and McKee of Sudbury. Got in from center ice by Moore, wide of the Detroit net. Rapier holds that in for Sudbury. Goes to Ron Newhook along the boards. Now Harmer for Detroit. Able to work it back, and Haggerty clears it. Will it be icing? Will they let it stand? No, they are going to let it stand. And the icing call brings the face off the other way. We'll take a break. Late in the first period, no score.
.324 to go in the first, no score. There's the big hit on Berard, the defenseman, as he deked to the left and tried to go back to the right, and he took the brunt of that hit on the left inside of the left thigh, and that's Charlie Horse department, boy, if you're not careful.
Brzezinski battling with Wilson. Two defensemen going at it there as the penalties to McCauley and McKee expired. Both teams back at full strength with 3:10 left in the period. One thing Paul Maurice told us about Berard, he is a finesse player, good offensive player, but not afraid to get involved in the physical part of the game. Centering attempt here. Mitchell with a chance to Mullen the stop, and he gathers in the loose puck after making the save. At one time, the shots were 4-1 in favor of Sudbury. Since then, the Junior Wings have outshot the Wolves 7-1, as it's now an 8-5 shooting advantage for Detroit.
The captain, Fitzpatrick, goes back to the box for Sudbury, so the Junior Wings will have a power play again. Once again, you see McCauley, Mitchell, and Haggerty up front.
Well, the Junior Red Wings will return to the ice here at Joe Louis Arena this coming Thursday night, November the 3rd, 7 o'clock, against the visiting Kitchener Rangers. And you can pick up tickets for the game at the Joe Louis Arena box office, or you can charge by phone by calling 645-6666, as the shorthanded Wolves putting pressure on Jason Saul on the Junior Red Wing net. And, of course, if you can't get down here for the game on Thursday night, we're going to have the action for you live right here on Pass, 7 o'clock Thursday night, Kitchener visiting Detroit.
The Kitchener Rangers. Red Wing Sean Bird did his junior hockey in Kitchener.
And here's the rest of the upcoming home game for the Junior Red Wings. So if you like the action you see here and want to get a close hand look at what the OHL is all about, why not get some tickets and come on down. Niagara Falls here on November the 10th. Oshawa on the 14th. Peterborough will be in.
The Beats of Peterborough. Got off to a very good start. Only 6 wins. Another cover up, and Saul feeds it off to a defenseman.
Haggerty backhands it now to Ball. He'll drop it back for Haggerty. Power play for the Junior Wings continues here as Ball gives it off in the corner. McCauley has it there. Just over 2 minutes left in the period. Ball at the hash marks, goes to McCauley. In deep, out to the point. Harmer winds up, drives the shot right through. And Mullen the save.
Tell you one thing, boy, you watch the front of the Sudbury net. See, the defenseman this time, I think it's Rosinski. Or Martin it is, yeah, in front of the net. Really clearing the zone. These guys do pay a price. Again, experience a lot to do with that. And obviously, Glenn Murkowski, he's got these guys drilled pretty well about how to protect that goaltender in the front of the net.
McCauley and Rochefort, the two number 19s. Junior Wings control. Harmer cross ice. Berard one-timer right off the shin pad of Rochefort. And it's backhanded out of the zone by Barry Moore, who will head to the bench as Sudbury gets some fresh penalty killers out there. Nice pass ahead.
Wow, that was close. That could have been offside.
Here's McCauley working his way in. Backhand pass intended for Ball. And it was just tipped. And the Wolves able to clear. Saw the goaltender out to move it quickly for Harmer. Now to Berard. Half a minute left in the Detroit power play. Berard looking to go wide himself. He cuts in, shoots, and he fired it just wide. Off the end boards, it's picked up by McCauley. McCauley centering pass. Haggerty couldn't get much of a shot away. Now you got Berard, and Berard's going to go at it with one of the big defensemen. It's McKee that gave him a pop, and Berard, not as big as McKee, but not afraid to stand in there and exchange with him. McKee's 6'2", 185 pounds. And Berard listed at 6'1", but it looks like a bigger difference than that.
Oh, there is.
After Berard had the great scoring chance, Mick, I was going to comment on the fact that he didn't immediately go back to the point. I think he saw that the Junior Wings had good balance. He had somebody backing him up back there, so he stayed right in the slot area and took some wax from McKee, and the gloves went down and away they went.
Once again, Mullen there.
Well, Berard got McKee a pretty good shot.
What started it? With those half masks on, boy, you can bust up your knuckles pretty good. You're not careful where you're hitting. Remember, I mean, McKee, or Berard rather, just 17 years old.
Well, Berard gave him a pop, we could see there, but McKee was the first one that threw a punch as far as the fight, so there is an extra two up for McKee, and it may be for just that reason. Glenn Murkowski's club now is going to be two men short for 19 seconds. That's the time remaining in the penalty to Rory Fitzpatrick.
Mind you, just checking the list here, McKee's just 17.
From Amherst View, Ontario.
How would you describe Murkowski when he played in Adirondack? Well, shifty centerman.
Shifty centerman, yep. And played wing as well. And I remember Bill Dineen used to say,
guy.
A hardworking guy from the blue line in, he was as good as anybody at that level.
Yeah.
He didn't have great speed. He wasn't going to go end to end and beat you, but very smart offensive player. And we'll see what the Junior Wings can do. They've controlled the faceoff. Now just 12 seconds left for the two-man advantage. Rosinski at the faceoff circle sends it across. One timer by Harmer, a save made. Harmer to McCauley. They work it back to Rosinski. And the penalty to Fitzpatrick has expired. He gets back into the play. Here is Ball centering pass. It went right by McCauley and Haggerty. And the Wolves able to clear. Harmer takes it into the Sudbury zone. Looked across, but faked the pass, goes to the corner instead to McCauley. Half a minute left in the period. Coming off the stick of the Sudbury defenseman Martin, recovered by Ball for the junior wing.
Tell you what, there have not been many close in, wide open opportunities on Mullen. Sudbury really mines the front of the net very, very well.
McCauley winds up, drives the shot, save Mullen, rebound, backhand attempt. Here's another opportunity for Ball, and Mullen was there to cover it up. Matt Ball and Scott Blair, it seems, have had the bulk of the scoring chances for the junior wings. The shot's now 14-7.
Again, you see the main shot came through from the point, went through the defenseman, hit Mullen easily in the pads and came back out. But Ball did not get much of a rebound. Yes, it would have gone in if it gets by the goaltender, but good defensive coverage in front of the net right there. They've got him covered. And just a soft shot towards the net. Covered easily by Mullen. 14-7 the shots on goal.
Matt Mullen, 5'6", 160 pounds. There's the shot that went off the stick of the Sudbury defenseman.
This kid plays his position exceptionally well. He moves around, looks at his position quite a bit in relationship to the goalpost. Very alert.
Well, that's going to do it for the first period of play. So after being outshot 4-1, Detroit gets 13 of the next 19 shots in the hockey game, but thanks largely to Matt Mullen, the Sudbury goaltender, much busier than Jason Saul, it is a scoreless game after 20 minutes of action. We'll be back with our first intermission, including a visit with Jim DeVolano, right after this. Twenty minutes completed here at the Joe Louis Arena. Sudbury and the Detroit Junior Red Wings scoreless after 20 minutes of play. We'll talk with Jim DeVolano in the next segment of our first intermission, but let's show you some numbers to indicate just how strong the OHL has been in supplying players to the National Hockey League. These are the number of draft picks since 1969 that have come out of the three teams that make up the Canadian Hockey League, the Ontario Hockey League, the Western League, and the Quebec Major Junior League. 1,326 players out of the Ontario Hockey League. And one of the all-time greats back in the 60s who played for Oshawa was Bobby Orr. Let's take a look at some of the great magic of number four.
In every sport, there is an athlete whose extraordinary skills and vision expand the limits of their game. In hockey, that athlete was a shy 18-year-old defenseman from Parry Sound, Ontario, who took his place on the blue line but refused to be defined by it. Bobby Orr transcended tradition, and in his wake, a generation of rushing defensemen has followed. Once, defensemen were judged on their ability to separate opposing players from the puck. But Bobby Orr took hockey out of the ice age with a revolutionary notion. The best defense is a good offense. Orr made the puck his personal possession, and in doing so, became more lethal than the highest scoring forwards. He also reintroduced the Stanley Cup to Boston, which had gone 29 years without drinking a champion's champagne, before Orr raised cups in 1970 and 72. Orr was the O.J. Simpson, Mickey Mantle, and Arnold Palmer of hockey players. And in a 12-year career that would have been even more glorious had he been able to play on more than one good knee, Orr lifted fans out of their seats in every arena he played in with his trademark length of the ice rushes. Bobby Orr knew the risks of subjecting his knees to the pounding they took night after night. He understood there was only so much hitting they would tolerate, but his game was carrying the puck. That's the way he chose to play the game, the only way he knew how to play the game. So he suffered in silence, willing to pay the price for his art, and the rest of us were richer for it. He was the league's top rookie, its most valuable player three straight seasons, its top defenseman eight times, its leading scorer twice. Bobby Orr scored the Stanley Cup winning goal in both of Boston's championship seasons. And in both of those years, he swept all four major awards: MVP, playoff MVP, top defenseman, and top scorer. Finally, in 1978, Orr was forced to retire, and at age 30, became the youngest player to be elected to the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Back at the Joe Louis Arena on a Sunday afternoon, the Junior Red Wings and Sudbury Wolves are scoreless after 20 minutes of play. And as we promised you, we are joined by Executive Vice President Jim Devolano of the Detroit Red Wings, who we had the pleasure to visit with over at the Yost Ice Arena in Ann Arbor last weekend with Michigan and Colorado College in that weekend series. Mickey and I have been talking about the difference in the style of play between the OHL, and it's probably true of the other junior leagues, and the college game. Jimmy, from a scouting standpoint, what are the differences that you see?
Well, I think the big difference is age, Dave. Here in junior hockey, of course, the boys range anywhere from 16 to 19, whereas in the colleges, it's more from 19 to 24. So there's a big age difference, and I think the college kid is maybe a little further advanced.
We talked a lot about this kid, Brian Berard, number 34, who was a first-round OHL pick, and you were just saying a few moments ago to Mickey and I that he's very likely to be a first-round NHL pick, and I guess how high he goes just determined by how he develops this year.
Well, that's right. There's no question Brian Berard is going to be a first-round draft pick in the 95 draft, and there's probably 50 scouts here from various NHL teams here today looking at him, and hopefully if we ever get the season going, we'll finish high enough that we won't get him.
Let's talk a little bit about the labor situation. I know there hasn't been a whole lot of word in the press. There hasn't been a lot of meetings, which I think is probably the most discouraging thing to anybody that's involved in the game, is why aren't they sitting down and talking? There has been some talk that there will be meetings this week. Have you heard anything along those lines?
Well, I've heard what you've heard, that there will be meetings this week. But you know, David, it's not one issue. There are about 10 issues, and both sides are so diametrically opposed on all the issues that it's really starting to be hard to be optimistic.
Well, Jimmy, worst case scenario, no NHL hockey this season. There's so many things that come to mind. I mean, we've been talking about this kid Berard and the draft. Would there be a draft next year if there were no season? What does it do for free agents who were going into their option year and now their option year is gone? And for example, a guy that has just signed a contract, let's say a four-year deal, if he sits out all of this year with the rest of the league, does it become a three-year deal next year? There's so many things that are going to be thrown just completely haywire if this thing doesn't get settled.
Well, there's no question about that. Anybody that would have a long-term contract, certainly if we didn't play this year, they would lose that year on their contract. But what do you do about the guys in their option years? Does that carry over another year? The lawyers are going to be busy as usual.
If this thing doesn't get settled, you go to next summer, you get close to training camp. Because this has been a lockout and not a strike, could the NHL, as Major League Baseball is talking about, say, we're going to open camp, we're going to invite all of our young kids, any of you veterans that want to come. Can you do that and start the season fresh in 95-96?
Well, I don't know the legalities of that, David, but that's certainly something that certainly needs to be investigated, because certainly you couldn't have hockey shut down for 2 years. That would really injure the sport forever. So certainly that's a possibility, but again, what are the legalities of that? Unfortunately, I'm a hockey man, and what's happened is this business has become very, very legal, and lawyers are involved, and practically every decision we make now, we need a lawyer. So that's something that's interesting, but it's certainly something that's crossed my mind, that you open the doors and find out who wants to play.
Talking with some people around the league, they say one of the problems is that the owners have never been more unified in their stance at any point in their history as they are now, and probably the same is true of the Players Association. Do you see any key people within the owners' ranks or within the players' ranks that may be able to go to a Bettman or to a Goodnow and say, look, we've got to soften our stance on this particular issue here or soften it over there, and let's try to get something done? Or are the leaders in each camp just saying, look, we're going to stick this out until we can get the system changed?
Well, right now, of course, you've got both sides that are very stuck on their side. And from our side, the owner's side, the management side, it's really to do with the salvation of the sport, the financial wherewithal to make the sport operate properly, and that's what's happening in baseball as well. So really what we're trying to do is put a financial situation in place so that the game can operate healthy, that the players can make big salaries and good money, which they very much deserve, and so that the owners can also make a little bit of profit for their investment.
I keep hearing the players say, we don't even care to look at the numbers. Some of them maybe have looked at the numbers and say it doesn't matter what they say because the books have been doctored. It doesn't matter whether they're audited or whatever the other technical terms are. Would there ever come a time that both sides would sit down with all of these books and open them up and say, okay, if you guys don't believe the numbers, I mean, the revenue streams in hockey, Jimmy, aren't that hard to point to and for the most part prove as far as ticket prices and television revenue. Why can't they sit down and look at these and say, okay, if you don't believe these numbers, then what do you think we're making?
David, you're absolutely right. It's very simple in our business. In our business, the majority of our revenue is tickets. The next biggest income is radio and television, and that's considerably less than the ticket revenue. And then you have some novelties and programs. And that's basically the revenues. A lot of times they want to talk about concessions, but you know, you have a big building to operate and you need those revenues to operate other things in the building. You have a lot of staff, you've got to keep ice in the building, there's electricity, there's air conditioning. So those are our revenues, and it's really not too hard to show the Players Association really what the income is and what the outgo is. And I know in our particular case, we raised ticket prices, and our increase in salaries over this summer will double the increase of what we're taking in tickets.
Jimmy, just to wrap it up, does the league have a date in mind? Right now, I know they're taking it very cautiously, very conservative, lopping off four games here. Supposedly, some more games are going to be canceled this week. Have they gotten to a point where they can say to themselves, look, if we don't have a deal by December 15th or January 1st, this thing is shut down? Because I still hear some of the players, apparently Joey Koser was on WJR, talking about this Fox television deal as being the hammer or the leverage that the players are going to have come January and the owners are going to give in. But is there a date in mind that the owners have said, you know, if we don't have a deal by then, there's really no point in having a season?
Well, I have to believe, and this is a personal opinion, Dave, I have to believe it's January 1. If we're not playing January 1, we can't have a meaningful season and then have Stanley Cup playoffs. That's my opinion. We've got to be going by January 1. And as a rebuttal to Joey Kosher's comment about the Fox deal, it's really less than $1 million a team. That's not gonna do it.
Well, we certainly hope that that somehow this gets resolved. And I guess what Mickey and I have said, Jimmy, is that regardless of which side comes closer to winning this thing, if that's the right term, I guess we all hope that whatever is done, it's for the betterment of the sport, and that we're not in this position a year, 2 years, 3 years down the line, that they can work a deal that's going to allow this thing to go on, and we can start talking about goals and assists instead of salary caps and revenue sharing.
Well, that's right. It's become awful legal, and it is disappointing. And if we don't straighten the game out this time, we'll be back in this mess, as you say, 2-3 years from now again. Let's get it solved. If it takes all year, but let's get it solved so that when the great NHL comes back, that it's a great sport, and we don't have to worry about, as you say, salary caps and arbitration and all these things.
All right, Jimmy, thanks very much. Jim DeBellano, our guest here in the first intermission at the Joe Louis Arena, where the Junior Red Wings and the Sudbury Wolves are scoreless after 20 minutes. Back with more after this. No scoring on the mobile scoring summary from the first period, but a couple of scoring chances at each end that we're going to have a look at as Detroit had the best of the shots on goal, 14-7, an excellent period for the Sudbury goaltender Mullen. Mick,
look at Ball, who made the play across the front, deflected by the defenseman. He follows through to pick up the puck, and look at Blair at the left of the screen. He's the guy that's going to be on the receiving end, but he hit the outside of the goalpost as Mullen quickly got back across to shut off the short side. That one of several that the Junior Wings had. Then Benedam, a forward for the Sudbury Wolves, got a chance from a bad angle, but you never know, put the puck at the net, it just might go in. But Saul had an easy time. All he's got to do there is hold the short side goalpost, and he did that. But Sudbury with very few good scoring chances in the first 20 minutes of play.
Paul Maurice's team will have 45 seconds still to work on a power play. That's the time remaining in the penalty to McKee. Well, we have an opportunity. Want to point out a couple of very popular events coming to the Joe Louis Arena. Walt Disney's Aladdin on Ice will be here November 16th through the 20th here at the Joe Louis Arena. Plenty of great seats still available. You can pick up tickets at the Joe Louis Arena box office or charge by phone by calling 810-645-6666. That's Walt Disney's Aladdin on Ice here at the Joe Louis Arena November 16th through the 20th. Junior Wings with the power play opportunity as Haggerty goes wide on Martin, who gave him a pretty good tap with the stick. Out to the point, and it slid underneath Brzezinski. And Harmer now back at the Detroit line will look to get things wound up for the Junior Wings with the extra man. Pass didn't connect with Haggerty. Now Harmer drags it into the Sudbury zone, but he's checked by Benedam, and the puck cleared by Martin. Now that's a souvenir.
You hit
up in the stands.
At least 15 rows up. In behind the benches.
Another event to point out that's coming here during the holiday season, Mick, the Nutcracker on Ice, being performed by some of the all-time great Olympic skating champions, Brian Boitano, Oksana Bayul, Victor Petrenko, will be here at the Joe Louis Arena for one performance only on December 22nd at 7:30, the traditional family holiday classic like you've never seen on ice. Pick up tickets again here at the Joe Louis box office or charge by phone, 645-6666. So a couple of great skating events, Walt Disney's Aladdin on Ice and the Nutcracker on Ice coming to Joe Louis Arena in the months of November and December. That ball tried to shove it in front. It never got through off the end boards. A quick pop at it for Blair, and Mullen scoops it up as the penalty to McKee has expired. Well, we mentioned that the Junior Red Wings are playing their third game in less than 3 days, and we asked Paul Maurice before the game on how that might affect this afternoon's performance.
Well, normally we'd say it's a little bit difficult. Fortunately, passes here, and it seems to give the guys a little bit of a jump. But in junior hockey, you know, these guys will surprise you. They've got a lot of legs, and we've worked very hard in practice this week. So it should be interesting. The first 10 minutes may be a little tough for us, but hopefully we can get into our groove and let it ride.
Well, that's been right on as far as getting things going, because as I mentioned a couple of times, the Sudbury Wolves have had a 4-1 advantage on the shot clock, and the Junior Wings really picked it up after that. The shots are now 15-7. But it's been Matt Mullen, only 5'6", standing tall in the Sudbury goal. Here's Gagne, and a rush gets through, and then he lost the puck off the end of the stick. It's loose in front of an open net as Jason Saul couldn't get back between the pipes, but the Junior Wings able to clear it out of harm's way. Rapier avoids Moroni, who took a run at him, number 13, the big tough guy for the Junior Wings out there. Number 14 is Andrew Dale out of Sudbury, Ontario, so a hometown kid for the Wolves. Back to the point, Frappier in along the end board. This is Dale behind the Detroit net, trying to work it out in front. But the Junior Wings with good position defensively. Look out up in that Detroit bench. That Arnie that ducked out of the way down there, Mick?
May have been.
There's the Sudbury forward, Gagne, who's shaken up on that rush. Anyway, crashing into the end boards after just lost control of the puck.
It banged his knee on the boards inside that shin pad as he went down in behind the net.
Two minutes gone by in the second period. Mullen out of the net for Sudbury to play it around the boards. Brzezinski read the play, jumped up to hold it in. Good play by Buckley to go back and support Brzezinski, who had gone in deep. Now Martin back behind the Sudbury goal. Run hard by Sika, forced a turnover, but Sudbury gets it right back. And it's cleared out of there by Ryan Shanahan, dumped right back in. Junior Wings trying to keep the pressure on. Here is Sika in again, forechecking. Hill, number 15, got it to Shanahan. Ryan Shanahan, a former Red Wing draft pick who the Red Wings didn't sign, so he'll go back into the draft pool. Brzezinski center ice for the Junior Wing. Shanahan putting the pressure on him. And Ryan McDonald, number 4, slid it ahead. Mullen out of the net for Sudbury. One handed the puck along the boards. It's blocked there by Lanigan, number 12. Now McCauley digs it out of there. McCauley backhands it toward the Sudbury goal. Stick to side. Haggerty tried to center it. Here's McCauley again. Good pressure. McCauley dumped it in front. Mullen able to get the stick along the ice. Two number 19s, McCauley and Rochefort, collide. As Detroit dumps it back into the Sudbury zone, Mullen very quickly out to play it off the boards. And Martin rips it cross ice. Light body back to chase it down in front of his goaltender. Wilson snaps it across. Driven in the zone by Frappier. And light body now for the junior wing. Ahead for ball. He's run hard by Wilson. The puck kept in by Moore, who got a long shot away. Saul handled that easily. Now Harmer played it ahead off the stick of McCauley. John Frappier, number 7, drives it back into the junior wing zone. Light body got there to play it off the boards. Sudbury trying to pick up the forechecking pressure a bit here and create some offense. Had a couple of long-range shots like that one, but nothing really threatening on Jason Saul. Back the other way, McCauley for the junior wing. Drives the shot, deflected wide. Ball with a collision there with Frappier at center ice. Ball has it again. Nifty little play to get it to Blair. Blair has Maroney with him. Blair cuts in, backhand shot, steered aside by Mullen, and back the other way come the Sudbury Wolves. Played 4.5 minutes here in the second period. Ball is bumped by Coupel, and the Wolves drive it back into the Detroit zone. McDonald, a little trouble handling the puck. Junior Wings able to clear. Fitzpatrick tried to drive it back into the Detroit zone. Junior Wings cleared it right back out. A little interference there by Fitzpatrick, wasn't it? Went down and threw a cross body block. Late offside, they wave it off, but the Wolves come out of there anyway. Coupel backhand pass, center ice. Brzezinski had it caught up in his jersey.
Ooh, look out
he
there.
He was dumped. Martin back behind the Sudbury net, around the boards. Coupel took a hit. Harmer able to hold it in for the junior wings. Now Mitchell digging after it. Martin, good defensive play. And Fitzpatrick got the stick on it for Sudbury and clear. Rink wide pass. Dale for the Wolves. Dumped it deep into the Detroit zone with the Wolves changing. Light body able to clear it, and Mitchell dumps it back into the Sudbury zone. Mitchell deflected that puck, but he wasn't sure where it went. Sudbury able to get it to center ice. Harmer, though, recovers, bangs it off the boards. They push it ahead for Mitchell. Wilson, though, number 5, he doesn't need too many strides, Mick, to make up any real estate.
Big hit there by Sika. 6'6", I guess not.
Right away, Frappier coming over on Sika after that hit. Gives him the cross check, and Sika grabs a hold of him and says, look, if you want to give me a couple of whacks with the lumber, you better be willing to stand up.
And probably he will get extra for that, because was it Frappier for Sudbury?
Yes.
Did not get the gloves and the stick off. We'll figure that out for you when we come back. No score in the hockey game.
Well, just one penalty up on the board against the junior wings. We talked about the homegrown junior Red Wings. You have Blair from Allen Park, McCauley from Warren, Mitchell from Wayne, Belichick, who's not in the lineup because of an injury, I believe, from Troy, Rosinski out of Dearborn, and the goaltender Saul from Sterling Heights. So that says a lot for the amateur programs in the Metro Detroit area. Of course, we talk about the NHLers like a Pat LaFontaine or the Hatcher boys, Darian and Kevin, that have come out of this area, Lee Norwood, Wayne Presley, there have been several. But boy, just to get to this level, as you know, Mick, you got to be a darn good hockey player.
Absolutely.
All the kids that play at the various levels from age 6 up to age 14, I don't know what percentage of them would make it to this level. I imagine it wouldn't be that many.
Very
of course,
small.
Even fewer that would move on and play at the professional level.
So many more youngsters playing the game today than there was 20 years ago. The numbers get smaller and smaller that end up at the professional level.
Sudbury with their third power play opportunity. I know, for example, I live in Troy myself, and there's a petition going around to try to get the city to build a rink. You know, you look at Berkeley and Royal Oak and Birmingham and the Detroit Skating Club. I mean, these rinks are just jam-packed, and there's a waiting list for kids to play at all different levels.
Yeah, if you want to have a pickup game, you got to go in the wee hours of the night anymore to rent some ice. Or the wee hours of the morning, as we're talking to the parents about yesterday's, all the Little Caesars coaches for their organization. Had a luncheon yesterday, and
all the House League coaches and managers were here yesterday, and I think the travel teams are all being represented this afternoon at the Olympia Club, as Saul stops that shot off the stick of Barry Moore. Power play here for Sudbury. No score in the hockey game. Moore sends it out to the line. Fitzpatrick, quick shot. That bounced off somebody in the deep slot, wide of the junior wing's goal. Now Berard takes a look around, and he'll play it around the board. McCauley will try to get there. He chops right at it. Haggerty's going to get to it. Now Haggerty, good speed. One-on-one against Wilson. Wilson, a big kid. See how he plays it. Wilson fell down, but Haggerty had lost the puck. Moore drives the shot. Saul just plays the angle, and it bounced off the defenseman light body, and Saul had to be alert on that one. It's covered up now and a whistle.
You take a look at the way this game is developing, almost to the halfway point. Not a goal scored, and Sudbury is the lowest scored against team in the OHL with 35 goals against in 13 games. Less than three, that is a low number for junior hockey. The next closest team has 45 goals against, almost a goal a game difference. There's that last rush from a end zone angle.
You know, we're talking about Wilson and his size. He was a first round pick of the Vancouver Canucks in 1993, the 20th pick overall, 6'6", 200 pounds from Brampton, Ontario.
Right by the Devil's Pulpit, where you haven't
I haven't played yet.
You haven't played up there yet.
I understand the fescue gave you a little trouble on that court.
Did so. Dozen balls or so.
Oh yeah. Well, that can happen on those kind of golf courses. We know that.
Fairway's about 70 yards wide to boot.
Nice play by Buckley. Passed it to himself to create a two-on-one. Buckley snaps the shot up high, and Mullen stopped that one, and the Wolves back the other way. Under 12 minutes remaining, second period. 10 seconds left in the penalty to Sika. Drop pass, and the late man coming, Martin, misfired on the shot. Will he get over to hold it in? He does. Knocked away by Rosinski. Sika's out of the box. He got himself onside, but couldn't get over to pick up the loose puck. There'll be an icing here against the Wolves as Lightbody goes back to touch it. Mentioning the weather outside this afternoon, still golf-like weather. We had an opportunity to go over and play one of the finer tracks in the area. Take a look at Quade Lightbody from Port Elgin, Ontario. It was picked up in a trade from Peterborough. Players move around in this OHL and the other leagues, sometimes much like the NHL. Guys will make trades. Just wondering if your buddies Dale and Rob will be up for a rematch.
I would imagine they'll want one after the lashes that they got laid on them.
Oh yeah.
I sent them over a big jar of bear grease to take the sting out of those lashes. Well, unusual, the weather this time of the year, and unusual because we would have been preparing for a home game here with the Red Wings.
Yeah, that's
on Friday
right.
night.
Well, after the conversation with Jim Devolano, nobody sounding very optimistic at all. Big hit by Chester Gallant, number 27. I don't know that he's played at all yet here this afternoon. He's out there with Newhook, 77. And Kupel, number 24, who has seen some action.
Kupel's their resident tough guy, and you got Maroney on for Detroit.
Got to stir something up. Play offside at the Detroit line. Chester Gallant, number 27, from Red Rock.
Red Rock. Ontario. Sounds like a John Wayne movie.
Not like Bedrock.
Red Rock.
Don't know if he's any relation to Gerard Gallant, who, of course, from Prince Edward Island. And speaking of Gerard Gallant, I was talking with Donnie Murdoch, former Red Wing, and now the chief scout of the Tampa Bay Lightning, and talking about Gallant still with the Tampa Bay Lightning organization. Of course, he was a very popular Detroit Red Wing and had some great seasons on the left side, mostly playing with Yzerman. Here's a chance, McCauley.
Good stop there.
Mullen the stop, loose puck, McCauley again, and a right toe save by Mullen. Now McDonald tried to drive it toward the net. It's cleared out of there. Brzezinski with Kupel right on his tail. They get it up near the line, but not out. A collision there. Shanahan, I think he left his feet. And the penalty coming again.
I think you're gonna might have a high stick here. It's Kupel trying to stir it up a little bit, but
well, the Sudbury players, I think it was Shanahan that come down the board. Looked like he left his feet, got airborne, delivered that check.
Hicks to the penalty box. What's he gonna call? Yes, indeed, a charge to Shanahan. Power play number what? Four, is it, for Detroit? Four or five?
This will be their fifth.
Fifth. Here's that last couple of opportunities by the junior wings, and a second stop by Mullen with that right toe, and a turnaround by McCauley. And here comes Shanahan. Up he goes.
Like a Sheldon Kennedy hit.
Yeah.
We'll see what the junior wings can do to try to find a chink in the armor of Mr. Matt Mullen and goal for the Sudbury Wolves. Oh, a giveaway here. Benedam shot, and Salt got a piece of it, then it may have hit Berard as well. Here is Haggerty into the zone. Good play by Ball to stay onside. Stretched himself out in order to do it. It comes back to the right point for Harmer. Harmer, top of the circle. Redirected by Haggerty, and the save made. Berard misfires on the follow-up attempt, and the puck cleared. Harmer back behind his own goal. Rochefort putting some pressure on him there. Now McCauley back to help out. Sudbury doing an excellent job here with the forecheck, in spite of being at a man disadvantage. Now there's two Sudbury players in there deep. Junior Wings can't get control. Now Ball finally works it ahead. There is Buckley into the zone with Haggerty.
Sudbury
back behind
down
the play.
Behind the play. No stoppage yet because they haven't touched the puck.
There is Haggerty behind the net. They get it out in front. Harmer swept the shot.
Finally the whistle goes.
Sudbury finally just sent another player out on the ice. It was number 19, Rochefort, that was down in the mid-ice area, and he hadn't even moved, and they just finally, I think Glenn Murkowski said, the heck with this, let's get a fourth skater down there and take our chances with the too many men on the ice call. We can pick
19.
It up.
19 White. What happened? He took a slash
to
the left side. Oh, there's a good elbow he took. Right in the chin. Knocked him down.
I thought that was a bad elbow.
Sudbury shorthanded. Gasol fired the puck right to his, and Berard made the stop.
Yep, it hit Saul, but then I think Berard may have kept it out of the net as Benedam had the opportunity on the turnover. 8:51 remaining in the second period. 33 seconds left in the Sudbury penalty to Shanahan. No score in the hockey game. Armor number 55 winds up, drives a shot. Mullen got the stick on that. Here's Blair at the hash marks to Buckley. Buckley also drafted by Hartford, as was Ball in the draft this past June. Side of the net, Blair tried to tuck it in front. Loose puck still there at the top of the circle. We got a Sudbury player that went down on top of it outside the crease.
I don't think there's been a time yet where Sudbury has been caught defensively without people in front of their goaltender. Boy, they really shut it down, and obviously that goal's against them, only 35.
in 13 games coming into today.
We were talking about Nedved before the game with Glenn Murkowski. Nedved scored 50 goals last year. You mentioned he's off to a bit of a slow start, but you know, sometimes those numbers can be deceiving. If the team is basically playing this style, they're not giving up a lot of goals and not taking a lot of chances offensively. Pay the price and do what he had to do to make the defensive play, and I guess that's all you can ask of guys, whether they're goal scorers or not, is to do what they're expected to do down in the defensive zone.
Well, offensive play and goal scoring isn't something normally you teach people. You just turn them loose when the opportunities are there and let them do their thing, and talent usually takes over. But the Sudbury people are telling me that the Toronto team that drafted Nedved have watched him play and are not happy with the way he's played so far and said, hey, come on, just because you've signed, we need you developing and working on your game if you expect to make this hockey club in the future. And that can be a problem with the young draft and of course big salaries and bonuses being paid, and a guy's got to play in junior. Look at Alexander Degg. He's back in junior playing for Victoriaville. Signed for $2.5 million a year with Ottawa last year. Is that strange or what? Mind you, he's not getting paid now because of the NHL situation and the impasse, but back making $40 a week in junior, riding the bus.
Benedam for the Wolves around the boards. Couldn't clear it by Blair the first time. A second effort. Got it to Moore, who slides it ahead. Shanahan back to Moore on the give and go. That's knocked away by Blair. Again, play getting a bit choppy. Not a whole lot happening offensively, really either direction, as late body, he'll take a hit from Nedved. Dale came up for the Sudbury Wolves as well. Now McKee tried to work his way in. There's a takeaway by Dale, looking to make the play, but good recovery, and a two-on-two the other way. Here's Buckley and Ball. And the shot in front was stopped by Mullen. There was some scrapping going on behind the play. It's 6:41 remaining in the second period. No score.
No score in the hockey game. A look at that last rush a moment ago by the junior wings. And watch the play as we take a look on the telestrator. It's a two-on-two. Watch this defenseman come across here and take the second forward out of the play, so he's got no place to go with the pass, and basically everything gets shut down around the net. That's good defensive play. Another defenseman hangs back in his position over by the hash marks. That's a drop pass and a scoring opportunity. Both these teams, I think, realize that they're not going to be in a 9-6 game, and they've really tightened it down and covering up, playing good defensive hockey.
Well, this has been a shift featuring several big hits already. Rosinski for the junior wing. Number 24, Gary Kupel, 6'1", 195. He's throwing his weight around out there. As is 27, Gallant. For Sudbury as it comes to center ice now. Kupel drives it across the Detroit zone. Gerard back to get it. Manages to make a tricky move, but he lost it there. Gerard back to recover deep in the Detroit zone. Two Sudbury players on him. He kicks it up to the stick, backhands it around the wall. Shanahan lets it go for the point man Martin. He dumps it back off the end wall. Barry Moore battling there with Berard. Now Buckley comes back to help out Sudbury with the pressure. It's hit for Martin. The best stop for Jason Saul in the hockey game, and it comes with just over 5 minutes left in the second period. Would have been a two-line pass. That's why the Sudbury player let it go. That bounces past Martin. He puts a bump on Buckley, but Buckley gets to the loose puck behind the net, dumps it right out in front. Shanahan is there, and he just lays it off the boards down the ice. Soft enough that there will not be an icing call. Armour goes to Mitchell. Mitchell center ice, drives it across the Sudbury zone. Big carom off the wall. Wilson, though, gets to it to clear it ahead. Here's Benedam with an opportunity. Score! What a shot there by Sean Benedam.
And Sudbury with a 1-0 lead, and it was just after that line with Capel and Gallant had come out and really changed the tempo of things, Mick.
Top corner with a wrist shot.
On the short side, really, with Benedam, as you see him move into the loose puck, pick it up, go to the middle, and shoot it back to the outside, and he did get some mustard on it.
Sixth of the year for number 12, Sean Benedam, a center out of Bally East, Ontario, just 18 years of age. And a 1-0 Sudbury lead. Big hit there by the Sudbury defenseman McKee, who then was hit from behind, and that's going to be the penalty. McKee put a hit on Ball, and then a junior Red Wing player came over and put a hit on McKee from behind. So Sudbury with a 1-0 lead will have a power play right after this. Watch what happens. Now, this is after McKee has delivered the hit to Ball, and it was Maroney, number 13, that came over and put the hit from behind and got a 4-minute penalty for that. So Maroney, 4 minutes for the hit from behind, and boy, this is a crucial stage of this hockey game. You know it's going to be a low-scoring affair. There's 1-0 Sudbury leading, but virtually the rest of the period, barring any other penalties, with a man advantage. Mickey Redmond is headed downstairs for a second intermission conversation with Berard. Here is Martin, redirected at the side of the net by Gagne. And Saul able to get a piece of that. Now it comes back to the hash mark. Benedam out to the point for Martin. Back to Benedam, who has the only goal of the hockey game now. Gagne in deep. Knocked away by McCauley, recovered by Berard. Tried to get it by Benedam, who stopped it with a skate. Back out top of the circle, a shot by Fitzpatrick, and that went wide off the skate. And the junior wing's able to clear it. 3:20 left in the period and 3:03 left in the double minor. What do we have now? The referee Hicks says stop the play. The puck may have been hit with a high stick. Well, we've been mentioning a lot of these small towns where the players in the OHL hail from, but here are the cities that have franchises in the OHL. And of course, you would expect the Ontario Hockey League to be primarily Ontario, with the exception of the team in Detroit, but you have Windsor, London, Sarnia, which are all fairly close to the Detroit area. Then you start moving toward Toronto with Guelph, Kitchener, Oshawa, Niagara Falls, and further out, Peterborough, Belleville, Kingston, Ottawa, North Bay, Sudbury, and Sault Ste. Marie. And some towns that certainly have produced some great, great hockey players in the NHL. Oh, it was a penalty to Sudbury. I thought the referee Hicks was indicating that the puck had been hit with a high stick, so that creates the 4-on-4 situation. It was Gagne who went off at 16:42. A chance here in the slot by Nedved. Nedved and Wilson assisted, incidentally, on the goal that was scored by Benedam at 15:30. Four skaters aside here. Nedved to Wilson. He is stood up by Berard. Berard involved in an altercation earlier in the game with the defenseman McKee from Sudbury. And Berard will be Mickey's guest in the second intermission. He gets a shot away here, and Mullen steers it aside. Harmer able to stop the clearing attempt, kicked it to the corner. It was knocked away by number 77, Ron Newhook of Sudbury, and the whistle to stop play. 2:03 remaining. Number 14 for the Sudbury Wolves, Andrew Dale, selected by the LA Kings in the sixth round of the 94 draft. You've got a half a dozen players on the Sudbury team that have been drafted already by NHL teams. And I count 8 junior Red Wing players, including, actually that's counting Scott Smith, who was traded to Owen Sound to pick up the tough guy Maroney. So this Puck ends up over the glass and out of play. A fan ducking out of the way. Allowed somebody behind him to get a souvenir. Look at Paul Maurice and the profile of this young man who is behind the bench, 27 years of age. Played in the OHL himself as a defenseman with Windsor, was drafted by the Philadelphia Flyers back in 85, was an assistant coach with the Spitfires for a couple of years, then with the Junior Wings, and was named head coach of this team back in August of 93. And then became the general manager, of course, with the CompuWare organization purchasing the Hartford Whalers and Jim Rutherford getting the job with Hartford. Paul Maurice becoming general manager and coach of the Junior Red Wings. Might be the only case in which you have the same ownership for an NHL team as you do a junior team. A chance right in front for Newhook, and I don't think he got the stick on it as he had an opportunity right in the crease. Out of the box comes Gagne, so Sudbury back with the man advantage. Minute 11 left in the period and 55 seconds left in the double minor to Maroney. And we get a meeting of the clan over along the boards. That's Dale that's being worked over by Harmer. Well, the linesman right there you're looking at, Scott Hoberg. His family has quite a tradition in the OHL. His father, Mike, officiated in both the OHL and the IHL during the 1970s and 80s. And Scott Hoberg continuing on a family tradition here in the OHL. And Berard was right in the middle of it again. And we are going to have penalties here. Andrew Dale, number 14, for Sudbury goes into the box. Berard going over to the Red Wing bench and heading into the penalty box for the Junior Wings will be Scott Blair. Glenn Murkowski, he was in Glens Falls with the Adirondack Red Wings when his playing days were over. He was an assistant coach for 1 year under Barry Melrose when they won the last of four Calder Cups that the Adirondack franchise has won. So Glenn got his first taste of coaching in Glens Falls, and I mentioned earlier he's been in Sudbury. This now his third year. Looks like it's going to be offsetting penalties to Dale of Sudbury and Blair of Detroit to keep it a 5-on-4 as Martin now off the draw, drives a shot right through, Saul to save, puck is loose. Moore had a chance at it. Saul still down on the ice and the Junior Wings break out with it. Less than a minute remaining in the period. McCauley. One-on-one, and boy, these Sudbury defensemen have played well. As Mickey pointed out a couple of times, they played well positionally. And one-on-one, they have been tough to beat. Martin gets it to center ice. Takes a bump from Haggerty as he drives it deep into the Detroit zone. It's picked up by Shanahan, number 11. He's checked by Haggerty. Now Moore again for Sudbury, gets over there. Shanahan recovers for the Wolves, gets it out to Martin at the left point. He's watched by Haggerty over to the right point for Fitzpatrick, and he lost it in the skates, and that allowed the Junior Wings to clear it. That was 19 McCauley that did the job, as you see the time remaining in the second period. Lead pass now Benedam, who still has the only goal of the hockey game. Drives it behind the Junior Wings net. Brzezinski just looked up as he was about to get crushed by Shanahan. And the horn will sound before Sudbury can get another pop at the Detroit goal. So just one goal in the period, and the only goal so far in the game at the 15:30 mark, scored by Sudbury's Sean Benedam, and that's the difference right now. It's a 1-0 Sudbury lead. Stay with us in our second intermission as Mickey Redmond will visit with number 34 of the Junior Red Wings, Brian Berard, the puck-rushing defenseman that we have a look at here. And we'll have his conversation with Mickey and more right after this. Well, Sudbury, living up to their billing, is one of the toughest teams to score against, and they took advantage of an opportunity late in the second, and they lead the Junior Red Wings 1-0 in OHL action here on a Sunday afternoon. And a guy that plays for the Junior Red Wings that is drawing a lot of attention already in his first year in the OHL is standing by downstairs with Mickey Redmond. He wears number 34, Brian Berard. Mick?
Brian, just getting the towel here. He said to me, three games in three nights. Come on in, Brian. We appreciate you coming in after the second period. Not easy, even for you young guys with a lot of energy, to go three games in three nights. And Sudbury, an experienced team that's really tying you guys up so far.
Yeah, it's pretty tough, especially for me to adapt to play high school hockey, play like twice a weekend, and I come up here and I play three games in three nights, and sometimes in our schedule we even got off four games in four nights, so it'll be tough.
How about the first period? You got in a little scrap with McKee out there. You're an offensive type defenseman. We've been talking about that throughout the first two periods. You must be used to that. You expect that you're going to take some licks when you go to the front of the net like you did on the play.
Yeah, I don't go out there looking for fights, but if it's there, I'm going to get in a little scrap and do the best I can do.
Here it comes up on our screen. Tell me a little bit about it. Did it hurt the hands when you're hitting that mat?
Yeah, actually, towards the end of the fight, I got my thumb caught in his eye tech there, his half shield, and I was trying to pull, but it wouldn't come undone, eh? Caught one good in the nose.
You took one?
Yeah, right in the nose, but that was all right.
You're a couple of 17-year-olds. There are some older players, obviously, in this league, 19 and 20 years old, some overage. How are you finding that adjustment coming out of Rhode Island to play with some bigger guys and some older guys and play against those guys?
It's been tough, but I've always liked playing against older guys. It's better competition and just helps my game develop a little more.
Junior hockey as opposed to college hockey, have you had a chance to really look at the decision that you made to come? Was it a tough decision, first of all, to forgo college and come to the OHL?
It was a long process. It took me, but I always wanted to play junior hockey. Tell you the truth, it wasn't really a tough decision for me. This is my type of game, and I just looked at that, and I just thought it would be the best level I could play into to progressing my game so I can play to the pro, make it to the next level.
How did you know it was your type of game? I mean, did you and your family take a look at the OHL and see the style of play as opposed to college and say, you know, this may suit me better, and I'm going to go that route?
Yes, actually, I came out here at my underage. I visited Joe Louis, and I saw Detroit play in the playoffs, actually, against Sault Ste. Marie when they got beat out 2 years ago with Pat Peake and Kevin Brown and those guys, and I just liked it ever since then. I would have liked to come here. I look back now, and I wish I would have came as an underage player.
How about when you look back to Rhode Island, not so far away time-wise, tell me a little bit about how you came up through the minor system and ended up here in Detroit.
Well, going through youth hockey, we've always had a great organization with the Woonsocket North Stars. I mean, my luck, I've been always on a winning team. We've won the states every year. I've played in with a couple guys like Chris King, Brian Glode, Brian Boucher. We've always excelled. And through there, I guess I get the experience and just helped me develop my game.
Being in Rhode Island, you probably would have seen a lot of Raymond Bourque on television with the Boston Bruins. Again, you're an offensive type guy. Has that always been the way you've played the game, head the puck up ice?
Yes, I've always liked to play the offense. I played I played forward 1 year, and I didn't like it. I'd rather be back in D. I can see more of the ice, and I like the physical part of the game also.
You figure you get a little more room to operate back there?
Yes.
And how about the power play? You're quarterbacking. We were talking about Jamie Rivers for Sudbury, who quarterbacks their power play. You get a lot of time on there. Has that surprised you, being just 17 with some older guys around?
Yeah, I have Dwayne Harbour, my partner. He's experienced. He's an OA in this league, so he helps me out a lot. And guys like Jamie Allison, they give me some pointers too.
How about reading the junior hockey so far? You had your expectations. You looked at it and said, this is my kind of game. Anything's really surprised you so far? I mean, it's only 14 games, but give me your thoughts on what you've seen in the OHL so far.
Well, I always heard this was the best league to come to, and I've always thought maybe it'd be a little overrated, but now this is a tough league, and this is the way to go. I think to all those hockey players, I'd like to play in the NHL someday.
How about your style? If you were to describe your style of play, what would it be?
Well, I'm an offensive type of defenseman. I like to quarterback. I like to move the puck quick. I also like to hit and get in a few scraps there and there.
A few scraps here and there. Talk about the draft next year. I'm sure you're keeping up with what's happening, the impasse in the NHL. I mean, there's a chance there may not be a draft, and I guess that's every young player's dream, to get drafted by an NHL team and go and play for the big boys. Any thoughts on what's been going on?
I'll tell you the truth. I just try to keep it. I think it's pretty far away. I just come out, play the best I can every night.
Let's take a look at who you might have looked at in the NHL. As I mentioned, I'm sure you saw a lot of Bourque, and of course, one of the best ever, maybe the best ever, to come out of the Boston area, Bobby Orr, who changed the game, revolutionized offense for a defenseman. Any favorite players and favorite teams in the NHL?
My favorite player is Mario Lemieux. I was kind of upset when I seen him. He was taking a year off, but he's had it tough with cancer and stuff, so Actually, I like Brian Leach now, too. He showed me during last year he's definitely a great defenseman. And I see how he's an offensive defenseman, but I don't like how people question his defensive play. I mean, he's a great defenseman, too.
If there was points in the game that you feel you need to work on, obviously you like the offense, and, of course, that's where the cash comes, goals and points, what have you these days. What parts of the game do you want to work on to get better at?
My skating, I think I need a little more work on. My defensive part of the game, moving up, closing up the gap. And I think then I can just keep on progressing, keep getting stronger, and hopefully someday.
Well, stay out of the front of the net at least, and stay on the ice to try to get all those points. Brian, we appreciate you coming by. Good luck in the third period, and good luck to the Junior Wings.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Brian Berard of the Junior Wings. After two periods of play, they trail the Sudbury Wolves 1-0. And David, take it away back upstairs.
All right, thank you, Mick. One of the many young fans enjoying the action here this afternoon, the day before Halloween. And we remind you that the Junior Red Wings on Pass is brought to you in part by Big Boy Restaurants, where you can taste the quality difference. We'll be back with more as our second intermission rolls along here on Pass Sports. Sudbury with a 1-0 lead here at the Joe Louis Arena. Minutes have gone by here at the Joe Louis Arena. The Junior Red Wings trail the Sudbury Wolves by a score of 1-0 in our first intermission, as we take a look at some more youngsters here enjoying the action this afternoon. We featured one of the great graduates of the OHL with Bobby Orr. We're going to have a look at another Bobby that played for the St. Catharines Blackhawks, the team no longer operating in the OHL, but produced some great players, including number 9, Bobby Hull.
Hockey was born into the modern era on the wings of a golden jet, Bobby Hull. Bobby Hull revolutionized the game with his bone-rattling slap shot. And with his blonde hair and matinee idol looks, Hull was tailor-made for hockey's first exposure on national television. In Chicago Stadium, however, Bobby Hull was a fire marshal's nightmare. Hockey fans packed the aisles and hung from the second-story balconies in the golden era of Blackhawk hockey. The Blackhawks haven't won a Stanley Cup since 1961, when the most feared left wing in the game was Bobby Hull. Time when 50 goal seasons were a rarity, Bobby Hull scored 50 or more goals 6 times and was the first to exceed 50 goals in a season when he had 54 in 1966. Other players had attempted slap shots before, but none were delivered with more terrifying power than Hull, which propelled the puck at speeds approaching 120 miles an hour toward those goaltenders brave enough to stand in their way. Struck by a Hull slap shot was to be seared by a branding iron or paralyzed by a speeding bullet. More than one masked man was shaken by the experience. You had to see it, they said, to believe it. But usually what you saw was only a rubber blur. Hull, powerfully built at 5'10", 193 pounds, was an electrifying sight when he launched one of his famous rushes. He was swift in his stride, reckless in his pursuit of a goal. And when he put a curve in his stick, he made the puck dance like a fast knuckleball, Though the Golden Jet eventually took flight from the Windy City, jumping to the WHA, he will always be the mayor of Madison Street in Chicago.
Number 12, Sean Benedam for the Sudbury Wolves. The only goal of the game set up by Nedved and Wilson. There you see the shot totals. 23 to 20 right now. And we're just underway in the third period. Teams are at full strength. Quite a bit of power play time there in the second period with all the penalties. There's an opportunity now for the Wolves, but Shanahan had it taken away, and Harmer starts to rush the other way. Nice move there, three on two. Harmer into the zone with McCauley, and McCauley up, and Lanigan.
Get it up to the head man, boy. They have to slow down at the blue line. You're taking it away from them. Get it to the head man and then follow the play to get it back.
Brian Berard talked about Harmer, his partner on defense. 20 years of age from Mitchell, Ontario. A veteran picked up in a trade from Guelph. Mitchell and Sika. Sika and Gallant playing opposite each other right now, having a few words before the faceoff. Rochefort for the Wolves, cross ice. Gallant has it there. Light body keeping an eye on him as the puck rolls in along the end boards behind Saul. Number seven for the junior wings, played it around Robin LaCour. There's a fifth defenseman dressed as we take a look at number 27, Jeff Mitchell, one of the local kids drafted by the LA Kings in 93. There is a fifth defenseman dressed this afternoon, number 33, Jamie Allison, but he has a groin injury and not able to play. He was dressed for the game last night, could not play. A few injuries bothering Paul Maurice's club right now, but hope to get some of the players back this week and hopefully in time for Thursday night's game here on Pass as they play host to Kitchener.
They had 19 drafts last night, didn't they?
Yes, so many. There's a chance, hit the goalpost. That was Gallant that drove it off the goalpost to the right of Saul.
Yeah, nice play there. Pretty creative.
Rochefort played it to himself off the back of the net. Good hit there by Lightbody as he and Gallant continue to battle.
Both the sticks are up to those two.
Centering pass didn't get through. Sudbury picking it up here. Light body, look out.
There's a knee. The light body's going right out there after him. Dropped the gloves and boom. And Gallant lost his helmet and shield. And that's what happened. His light body took exception to the knee being stuck out by Gallant. And that's a play that can
the referee
put you
was
on
there,
the sidelines.
I thought had a good look at him.
And he wasn't going to call a penalty. We will take another look here in a moment at the original hit. And okay.
Well, his name might be Lightbody, but he's not a Lightbody. Number two for
the
Detroit, 6'2", 195, and Gallant goes off.
This is the shot that hit the inside of the goalpost to the right of Saul, goes to the left side, and here's Gallant in the middle of the play. Watch this play get set up here. We'll carry it on. And it'll come back out to the left side right here. There's Gallant right there where he lost the helmet, right there in the tie-up. As they scrum for it, here's the two of them where they start right down in the corner. And now you're going to see the hit come out. Watch Gallant's out here. He's knocking into everybody he can. He's going to come across here,
Hold it right there. Watch the knee. Boom. There it is.
Stuck out that left leg.
Left knee and the right knee. And you can see light body react immediately to it. Players do not like that when they got a chance to get seriously injured. And therefore, the just the cuffs afterwards. It's like coincidental minor penalties. The referee's been hit. He's shaken up. The play will go on. Cuff it out. Attaboy, Hicks.
5 minutes each for fighting. Coincidental majors, Mick. Lead pass for Ball was just out of his reach. Still a 1-0 Sudbury lead. We are early in the third period here on a Sunday afternoon at the Joe Louis Arena. McDonald with a hit.
Out here.
Gagne. Now Maroney. He's bumped by Wilson. Puck comes loose. Blair couldn't recover. And it's Wilson back to get it. Sends it across now for Nedved. Nedved drops it back. Wilson rolls it deep into the Detroit zone. McDonald will play it around the boards. Lanigan is there. Shanahan forces a turnover. Benedam, though, his centering pass didn't get through. And I think McDonald, the defenseman for the junior wings, is going to go off here for interference. He got tied up with the Sudbury player to the right of the Detroit goal. So at 2:55 of the third period, junior wings trailing by one, Mick, shorthanded.
McDonald comes in from behind right there. Yeah, not much of a call. Play wasn't coming into the area where Shanahan was at, but.
Well, we've been showing you the OHL and college hockey. We remind you that the Joe Louis Arena is home of the most prestigious college hockey events in the country. Proud to present the college hockey season ticket. Now you'll be able to see not only the 30th annual Great Lakes Invitational, but Michigan versus Michigan State. And the CCHA playoffs later on in the spring. 8 action-packed games for only $60. College hockey season ticket is available at the Joe Louis Arena box office, or you can call, and you might want to write this number down, 313-396-7575. As you see the banner here, designating the Joe Louis Arena as the home of the CCHA championship.
You notice here on this Sudbury power play, they lead it 1-0, minute 52 to go. They got Fitzpatrick on the right point and Martin on the left point. Number 8, Rivers, has not returned after being shaken up in the first period.
Nope, you're right.
Helped off to the dressing room. And we've not gotten a report as to the nature of the injury. It looked like a leg, a knee, or an ankle.
Fitzpatrick starts it back now for the Wolves. Martin will drive it hard behind Saul, who just lets it go in behind him. Now Berard trying to tie it up there. 3 Sudbury players are on him. The Wolves dig it out of there. Back to the point. Fitzpatrick, a shot right through. Barry Moore screening in front of Saul, but the junior wings get it to center ice. There's Berard leading the rush. Cuts back to the inside and just pushed off the puck by Fitzpatrick. Berard looked like he was setting up to try to slide it across to McCauley.
Reese was saying that Berard is a strange kind of a player in the sense that he can look very, very tired and completely out of it. The next thing you know, he's gone, but he's got that style of play. Doesn't waste any energy. Very, very smart player. And very well spoken to boot.
Yep, did very well. I mean, it's covered up here by the goaltender, Saul. It's not an easy situation for a 17-year-old kid just out of high school, coming to a major market like Detroit to play in the OHL and being interviewed by one of the OHL's great graduates out of Peterborough, Mickey Redmond. I thought he handled himself very well, though.
Very well. Too many years ago to remember. I mean, I think I graduated out of junior in 1967. It's almost 30 years ago, boy. Here's the young man. He makes a good offensive move, but he got tied up well defensively by Moore.
Yeah, I think right there he knew he had.
Fitzpatrick, rather.
He knew he had McCauley over there. Just couldn't get it to him. Martin tries to snap it in front. Deflected. Rebound. They score, and it's Benedam again. That will get his second goal of the game. It'll be a power play goal and a little bit of a scrap after the goal was scored as Harmer for the junior wings and Dale for the Wolves got tied up. But Benedam will get his second of the game. and seventh of the season.
Easy pickings on that one for Vinadam because the puck was deflected on the original shot. It even then hit the goaltender Saul right off the faceoff. There's Vinadam, number 12. Watch the deflection here. Goes off a player out in front. Boom, hits the goaltender. Here's Vinadam right here. His move now, and bingo, an open net. Second goal of the game. This play here almost took a right angle. It was meant to be a pass, and boom, right in the open side. No problem for number 12. He reminds you of Rob Airey, the style of play, Vinadam.
I like that new Telestrator.
It's pretty good.
Finger touch control. You don't need to use the pen. Just touch the screen. The lines come up.
Yeah, you could go nuts on that thing, I'm sure.
Oh, it's just so much easier to use.
Yeah. Well, let's hope that we get a chance to use it a lot more than we have.
Yeah, that's right. Well, of course, one of the things is, if you didn't hear the conversation with Jim Devolano with the play called offside that we had in our first intermission, you know, the frustrating thing is not knowing when some kind of a decision is going to be made. That's why I was asking him about deadlines, if the league has thought about how late can you go. His personal opinion was the first of the year. If there isn't a deal by then, he doesn't see any NHL hockey played this season. And, of course, at that point, a lot of decisions would have to be made, but I'm sure one of the things that you and I would be involved in is perhaps seeing a lot more of the OHL, more of the college games, hopefully a little bit more of the American Hockey League with the Adirondack Wings. We've got one of those games scheduled for November the 10th.
Well, I mean, let's put it this way. You got to have a good number of games. Here comes Detroit.
Chance for it. Score! Boy, did he drive that one. Where no goaltender's got a chance to get it, regardless of how well he's been playing. And Matt Mullen has been acrobatic at times, but McCauley just drilled it in the top corner.
Almost a broken play inside the Sudbury blue line. And let's have a look at it. Berard, the defenseman, leads it out. Over to Haggerty. And McCauley came in behind. You see Kupal turned his back to McCauley, and it went off the wrist, I think, of Mullen up into the top corner. Watch 19 right here. There goes Kupal over here. Didn't pay attention to McCauley, and boom, right in the top corner. Bingo, bango, 2-1.
10th of the year for McCauley at 5:15. Less than a minute after the second goal for Vinadam to make it 2-0. So that's a big goal for the junior wing.
Just to follow that thought, there's a chip shot up into the clock. But, well, we're going to take a break, and we'll be back to finish those thoughts in just a moment. 2-1, Detroit trails Sudbury in the third.
McCauley got the goal for the junior Red Wings. His 10th of the year at 5:15 from Haggerty and Berard. I know you wanted to finish that thought as we talked to Jim Devolano not only this afternoon but last week during our Michigan game. And he felt you have to have at least 50 games to have a legitimate season. At least that would give you a chance for every team to play every other team twice if that's the format you wanted to follow.
Absolutely. And you could start in January and play. Right now they'll play about 13 games a month on average. You play 13 to 15 games a month.
Here's Dale one-on-one against Berard, and Berard, good job against Dale, who still got the weak one-handed shot away, and then the net came off and Dale went into the end boards, and now the Sudbury player, Kylie Hill, number 15, I believe, who hasn't seen a whole lot of action here this afternoon, taking exception.
And to finish it up, you could play for 4 months, January, February, March, and April, and still have 2 months of playoffs. May and June. Berard with the defensive play. The net off the moorings, and that's all she wrote. Good job there by Dale to use the left arm, the left knee, to try to cut in, but Berard took him down and did not take a penalty in the process.
Well, we mentioned that we talk about the players that have come out of this area into the NHL, specifically the players that have played in the CompuWare program. Jimmy Carson, Kevin Hatcher, Al Iafredi, Pat LaFontaine, Mike Modano, Eric Lindros, Brian Ralston, Pat Peek and Todd Harvey. Todd Harvey, I believe, has been practicing with the Junior Wings and is eligible to play, of course, top draft pick of the Dallas Stars.
Well, Detroit lost over 200 goals last year with guys graduating and being drafted. Ed Harvey had over 50. Also Brown and Wren. It was eight players that graduated from the hockey club.
Yeah, Kevin Brown, who had 54 goals. Wren, who had 45. Harding, who had 41. Harvey had 34 goals in just 49 games.
They had four 50-goal scorers, didn't they? And a couple of 40-goal scorers last year. Well, they only have the three 50s.
Face off now to the left of Jason Saul with 14 minutes straight up left in the third period. Sudbury 2, the Junior Wings 1. Lead pass for Sika, deflected off of him, and it's slapped away by Fitzpatrick to center ice. Rosinski and Harmer paired together. They get it ahead now for Mitchell. Mitchell cuts back between the circles. There's a chance for Buckley, and he lifted it too high. There's a turnover and an opportunity for Nedved. He's cut down, and what's the call going to be?
What do we got?
A tripping call. Yeah. Looking for the penalty shot,
yeah.
Right?
Absolutely. I'd have to see that again. The trip was made. I don't know that the puck was deflected away with the trip at the same time. Let's take a look at Nedved. No, he did not get the puck. That could have been a penalty shot. He was at a bad angle. It'll only be a tripping call. Certainly had cause for a penalty shot to be called. Sika doesn't think so.
Well, he may be arguing that he thought he got the puck, but not the case. Of course, you mentioned, Mick, that the Junior League's top prize, the Memorial Cup, Kamloops out of the Western Hockey League, has won it two of the last 3 years, including last year. Out to Fitzpatrick, back now to Benedam, who has both Sudbury goals. In the corner, Dale tries to walk it out in front, knocked away by Saul. Now Rosinski, number five, trying to tie it up, but they dig it out of his skates. Up along the boards, it got to Haggerty. He could not get it by Benedam. Wolves will set it up. Benedam fakes the shot, goes in deep off the boards for Dale. He's checked by Harmer.
Doesn't Benedam, number 12, remind you of Rob Airey of San Jose?
Yeah.
That same number, by the way, too, but left-handed shot physically resembles Airey.
5'10", 175 pounds, about the same size.
The Memorial Cup, of course, contested by the OHL, the Quebec Major Junior League, and the Western Hockey League.
The playoff champion from each of the three leagues goes, and then the host city I believe is an automatic berth, is it?
Don't get too far into that one. I'm not sure, because that has changed over the years, and there's been, you know, some complaints about the way they have to play. Sometimes you play back-to-back with the same team, even though you might have beaten them or lost to them. But, yeah, they have to have the four teams, and the host city is pre-chosen. And there's a round-robin type playoff.
I know Laval was the host city last year. It was Kamloops that won it. North Bay was the playoff champion for the OHL and Chicoutimi for the Quebec League. Nedved, a steal here by McCauley. He just missed ball with a pass. He looked over his shoulder, knew he was there. Looks like a quarterback leading a receiver. If he puts it out there a little further, could have skated into it, may have gotten the breakaway. 35 seconds left in the Detroit penalty to Sika. Just under 12 minutes left in the third. It's a 2-1 Sudbury lead. Here's a steal by Ball, looking to break with Mitchell. It was poked away by Fitzpatrick. Back inside the Sudbury zone. Neil Martin starts it back. Center ice, he's taken down by Mitchell, and no call.
He's that knee out again, and he's shaking up, Martin. Heads to the bench.
Coupel now up the right side. Drop pass, Shanahan. Fanned on the shot. Puck recovered by Berard. You know he's going to look to go. Sets it up the left side. He's got Buckley with him. Sika comes out of the box. Berard cuts back to the outside. Puts on the brakes. Berard still has a cross ice chance here. Fired wide. It was Buckley that Berard set up.
Bouncing puck, Buckley again fired it wide. Sika behind the net, and the net comes off the supports, and we're going to have a Sudbury penalty, I believe. The referee, Mark Hicks, has the arm in the air, and it's going to be a cross-checking penalty. And the junior wings, themselves just shorthanded and killing it off, will have a power play opportunity now with 11-12 left in the third period.
Berard again doing what he loves to do so much, lead that offense. Big Wilson again tripped up. He's got to grow into that body. He's 6 foot six yet. He's just 18 years old. And a couple of near misses by the junior wing. This one hit the outside of the net. Mullen goes down like so many young goaltenders today, takes away everything low.
And it's number seven, Sean Frappier, that you saw in behind the Sudbury net that drew the attention of the referee with the cross-checking call. So Detroit will have power play number six.
Sudbury was not in the OHL when I played many years ago. They were telling me there's a high stick coming up to Sudbury. It's going to be a 5-on-3.
Only 10 seconds gone off the penalty to Frappier.
Maybe a 5-minute major. We'll see, or two minors. See what Hicks calls. We know it's a high stick. How much he gets, we'll wait and see.
8:58 will be the time of the penalty here against Barry Moore, number 18.
Just 2 minutes, okay. But their radio people were telling me they're drawing 3,500, 4,000 a game up in Sudbury. Nickel country.
Ron Duguay played in Sudbury, did he not? Or yeah. Came from Sudbury?
Yeah. The North Bay, the old North Bay Trappers. They were not in the league either. Owen Sound is now in the league. Well.
We had a little piece there on Bobby Hull in the second intermission playing for the St. Catharines Blackhawks. And when I was working for Adirondack in the American League for a couple of years, St. Catharines had the Toronto Maple Leafs,
right?
Farm club, the St. Catharines Saints. There's some great stories about the games played in that small rink there.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll tell you who you would have loved is Rex Timers, the broadcaster.
Was he the announcer? Okay,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, my, was he a beauty.
Here's Barrett now.
Just to have everything was a save from 1 to 10 bells. He was excited.
Is he the same guy that fell out of the boot?
Yes, he did.
Harmer with a shot that got to the hash marks and hit someone, and now Ball, a good job to get it to Harmer. Shot by Berard, whistle. Why the Sudbury bench just up screaming? They wanted a penalty. And Glenn Murkowski just giving it to the referee. Never knew Glenn was that vocal. Such a quiet guy when he played. Here's Haggerty. Drops it back for Ball. Still over a minute left on the two-man advantage. The junior wings trailing 2-1. A golden opportunity to get back even to this one. Now Ball drives a shot. Mullen just steered that one aside, held his ground on the short side.
He's got to work something down low. Look at this, interesting the way Sudbury's playing it. Almost stacked 1-2-3 from front back to the goaler.
Berard's shot did not get by the first man, Rochefort. Now it's back to Berard at the line. Fakes the shot, gives it off to Harmer. It went through his legs. Wilson backhands it, and it's out of the zone. Back to get it, Berard. Sudbury will change up quickly. We got two players out there. Now they get the third one. Here's Berard on the rush. Gives it off to Haggerty. Back to Berard in deep. Got a man on the far side. Can't get it to him.
They'll go to 55 over here.
Now they get it in deep. Back out to Berard. He's got Harmer. Open Harmer, the one-timer. Mullen the save. McCauley was there looking to redirect it. Just 5 seconds left in the two-man advantage. In the corner, Haggerty mishandled it. Good job by Rochefort to tie him up. Now they get it to Harmer. Top of the circle. Harmer's shot was blocked. Frappier out of the box. 5 seconds. Moore will be out as well. Back to Berard. To Harmer. Into the faceoff circle for Haggerty. And Moore comes out. And a great job by the Sudbury penalty killer. Here's an opportunity for McCauley walking out in front. And he slid it wide.
He really did not get a great opportunity with the 5-on-3.
Here's Harmer right back up into the Sudbury zone. Rolls it in deep. Ball centering pass to Flex back to Rosinski. Gets a shot away and a glove save by Mullen. That puck was knuckling on the way in. 8.5 left in the third. And here's a turnover
And a steal by Dale sends it across. It went through Gagne. And Blair gives it off. And Buckley now drops it off for Sika. Drives it in from center ice. Mullen out of the net to settle it down there. He'll backhand it up the wall. Sika gets there to play it to the corner. Neil Martin thought he had it. That hit something along the boards. Light body rolls it to the corner. Picked up by Buckley. Buckley to Sika. Backhand shot went wide.
The man-for-man coverage by Sudbury. Incredible. Look at this.
Well, light body jumped up there. Buckley couldn't get it to him. Penalty coming. And what's it going to be?
I wonder if it's against Detroit for interference. I think it is. And Sudbury with 7:50 to go and the lead by one will go to the power play with Mr. Hicks. Whistling Mitchell, I believe, to the penalty box. Back in a moment.
The Junior Red Wings on Pass Sports is brought to you in part by Total. Total in over 30 countries, we get you there.
Mitchell for interference at 12:10. They call him roughing? Okay. Miscue here.
Chance for Haggerty, and he sailed it wide on a backhand short-handed opportunity. 12:10, the time of the penalty here in the third period to the Junior Wings, Mitchell. You may see the Junior Wings look to take some chances. They've got McCauley and Haggerty, two of their better offensive players out there in the penalty-killing situation. Back to the point, Fitzpatrick, a shot whistled wide. McCauley spotted the opening and able to get the puck back into the neutral zone. Now this is Moore. Carries ahead into the Detroit zone. Nedved works it in deep. Rosinski for the Junior Wings. Now Buckley was checked. Rochefort for Sudbury. They roll it back behind the Detroit goal. Racing after it. Light body gets there. Couldn't get it by Fitzpatrick. His pass hopped over the stick of Rochefort. And the Junior Wings able to clear.
Yeah, they got a bad break there, but that's just a good example. Fitzpatrick, of course, a veteran player here. They don't make too many bad plays, Sudbury. They seem to recognize the opportunity in the opening and make that play right away. And that tells you why they are 9-3 coming into today.
Here is Gagne. Played virtually the whole game without one of their top players and their leading scorer, Jamie Rivers, a defenseman hurt in the first period. Here is Dale for the Wolves again. 24 seconds left in the penalty to Mitchell. Dale at the top of the circle. His shot hit escape. It came right back to him. Backhand shot was stopped by Saul. Loose puck top of the crease. Back to the line. Wilson's shot picked up by Gagne, and his slow backhander was covered by Jason Saul.
Somebody's mad at somebody out there. Look out, they're all going after the same guy, and I can't see who it is. A real pileup in the corner down there.
Might have been Shanahan.
There's that Harmon and Shanahan now, away from the pack. The three Junior Red Wings went after one Wolf. And we were talking earlier in the show about the travel and the schooling and how important it is for young players. And Maurice was telling me before the game that they're only going to miss 6 days of school with their travel this year. That's very good.
See what they were upset about.
Keep your eye on a goaltender right down here. Watch what happens here.
Oh, yeah. There's Shanahan, and then he took a...
gave him a spear with the big goal stick.
What would you call that? Dances with Wolves?
Well, there's only one of them.
Yeah, that's right.
The Lone Wolf.
Jason Saul out of Sterling Heights. Pretty good numbers coming into action this afternoon. A 3.18 goals against average. He, too, an LA Kings draft pick back in 93.
Big boy.
Jamie Storr, the highly touted goaltender that was drafted this past June by LA, I believe has gone back to junior.
6 minutes straight up to go, third period, 2-1. Sudbury continues to lead. A very tight checking hockey game, only 53 shots between the two teams.
we had coincidental minors.
Mitchell's back out now, so five skaters aside. Puck up into the Wolves bench.
It was Harmer.
The Wolves bench, rather.
And Shanahan for Sudbury.
Thursday night, David, excuse me, we'll be back here on Pass. Junior Wings against the Kitchener Rangers, 7 o'clock. Face-off time right here on Pass. Paul Coffey play his junior in Kitchener as well. You mentioned Sean Burr had a brilliant junior career with the Rangers. I think Coffey played there with Kitchener as well on his way to Edmonton and several Stanley Cups.
I believe he did. And you and I will be back out at the Yost Arena in Ann Arbor next Saturday for a CCHA contest, Lake Superior State. Of the Michigan Wolverines. They split again this weekend with Ferris State as league action has opened up. Nice move by Berard there. Tried to go to the side of the net for a ball who was covered and the Wolves able to clear. Here is Ball trying to go one-on-one against Martin. Got the puck through him and we're going to have a penalty here.
Holding? I'll bet you that's a holding call to Martin. What do you think?
He may have grabbed the stick.
Yeah.
It is going to be a holding call, yes.
A couple other guys that Frank Galvin downstairs were just telling me that also came out of Kitchener. Seemed to have a lock on some of these big defensemen in the NHL. Scott Stevens is now with New Jersey via St. Louis. And the compensation fiasco. Al McInnes, the booming shot, who's now in St. Louis via Calgary. There's the hold right there. Two hands on the stick, no problem. Three hands on. Somebody's going to go.
And it is Neil Martin, the defenseman number six, that goes off. And I've got this unofficially as power play number eight for the junior wing. Sudbury has, we're going to have coincidental penalties. Well, Martin went off, but so did Blair for the junior wings. I did not see that indication. Apologize.
I don't know that he was going to call that originally. May have happened after the play.
Four skaters aside then with just under 5 minutes to go now in a 3-on-2 rush here for the Wolves. Dale going wide. He had Wilson and Nedved on in front. The puck turned over and look how quickly Sudbury gets back. He's got it well covered right now. Haggerty looking for some place to go with it. Made a move on McKee but couldn't get free. And back the other way, Andrew Dale for the Wolves. Lightbody has him covered and the shot sails wide of the junior wing's net. Fitzpatrick held it in, but Lightbody picks it up. Starts it back the other way with Haggerty and McCauley, but the play wasn't completed. Now Nedved takes over for Sudbury. Nedved between the circles. Nedved goes wide on Berard, dumped it right in front. Nobody there for the Wolves to pick up the pass. Lead pass for Berard. Center ice. Tries to drive it deep into the Sudbury zone. That hit one of the Wolves players. Came right back to center ice. And now the Wolves drive it in behind Saul and back to get it there. For Detroit, Mike Wazinski, number five. Ron Newhook watching him closely for Sudbury. Now Buckley, rink wide pass. He's got Mitchell loose behind the defense. He tries a shot and he lifted it too high. He did get loose, but Wilson was close enough to him that he couldn't get a clear shot at it. Four skaters aside. When these coincidental penalties expire, there will be exactly 3 minutes left in regulation time. Good stop there. Again, Ball with the good hands and looked like an innocent play, but forced Mullen to make the stop. It remains 2-1 Sudbury.
3:20 to go in the period as we let her go, guys. We'll see what happened here. A little lesson maybe for defensemen when you get caught standing still. Light body number two over here. Here comes Nedved up the middle here. And watch what happens to Berard. He's standing still easily. Out to the outside comes Nedved. And you cannot stand still. You got to keep those feet moving. That's what the coaches will tell you. Don't stand still in the game of hockey or they're going to make you look bad.
How'd you get the different color to come out of your finger that time? Well, that's great.
Saw with the save and the puck up
over his shoulder.
Where'd the whistle go?
I'm not sure. The whistle went.
Did it? Is that a whistle that I heard?
I thought I heard it as well. And asking for the trainer to come out. Their old buddy Arnie out there, isn't it?
Arnie Kurchian. Kurchian.
Kurchian?
Came on the road with us last year.
John Wharton and his wife Jeannie were expecting their baby.
Right, right, in St. Louis. And he very ably filled in.
Still talks about their road trip.
Yeah. Yeah, he does, doesn't he?
See if we can pick up the whistle here.
Hits all high. Yep. Hit him high. And he may have blown the whistle thinking the goalie was hurt, but that was a bit of a premature whistle. That puck may have gone in the net. But Saul turned around and stopped it.
We'll have to get the official pronunciation from Arnie on that last name. Do him justice there. But yeah, he had a great time on the road trip and
saw a few of the sights.
Backup goaltender Aaron Ellis played a strong game in the victory over Guelph last night. Down to 3:02 left in the third period. Just 2 seconds. Blair and Martin will come out of their respective penalty boxes. See the shots on goal. Nearly even again. After Detroit had a big advantage. Well, Blair comes out. He stays in the play. Martin goes to the bench, replaced by Shanahan. Here's McCauley on the rush. Drops it back. Good opportunity for Haggerty, and again Mullen there to make the stop.
Kid's a solid goaltender, isn't he? You have goaltending like that, boy. I mean, they can carry you a long way. You can afford to make mistakes and get away with it. Make that big save for you when you're in tight games, and it looks like Sudbury plays a lot of tight games. You look at their goals for, only 58 goals for. And that big 35 against.
Right, Mullen again, sharp as it comes out to the line. Harmer holds it in, rolls it back in behind the Sudbury goal. Benedam, who has both of the Sudbury goals, tried to work it around the boards, and it flies into the seats out of play. Take a look at the standings. As we showed you at the top of the show, again, to familiarize you a little bit more with the OHL, Detroit participating in the West Division. Despite of losing a lot of great players and a lot of scoring punch after the 10-3 start with Windsor and Sault Ste. Marie, Sarnia, and London following.
Well, Sudbury, out of 16 teams, right dead in the middle, eight with 58 goals for. A little over four a game, and that big 35, which is a little less than three a game against.
Under 2.5 remaining, about another minute if nothing changes on the scoreboard. We'll keep an eye on Jason Saul in the Detroit goal. Puck is deep in the Sudbury zone. Just over 2 minutes remaining now. Haggerty, who had the excellent scoring chance a moment ago, sends it out to Berard. Berard drives the shot. It's in the glove of Mullen, and he hangs on. Well, a reminder that Peyto Marhedic returns to Detroit to help the Detroit Rockers fight off the Kansas City Attack on Saturday, November 5th at 7 o'clock, right next door to the Joe Louis Arena at the Cobo Arena. For great indoor soccer action, call Ticketmaster 645-6666. Mullen really make a pretty good look at that shot all the way in.
Nobody in front, really one player there, McCauley, I believe it was. And he was tied up again. Sudbury's done a great job. And Detroit really hasn't gotten any real good second opportunities, even when Mullen has stopped the first one. And Blair may have had the best second shot, and Mullen made a spectacular stop on that in this first period.
Loose puck between the circles. Mitchell picks it up, wheels to fire. It was blocked. Now Buckley has it. They dump it toward the net again, and Mullen has it covered.
And the coverage again. Four Sudbury players between the circles. We're into a real
zone coverage, man-to-man coverage, hooking and holding, tying people up.
Well, they're having a great time here on a Sunday afternoon. In spite of the fact that the home team is down 2-1 with a minute 44 left on the clock, there's still plenty of time, of course, for that to change. Jason Saul still down between the pipes to our right. Paul Maurice behind the Detroit bench, checking the clock. Now Maroney. Had it knocked away. Harmer backhands it, center ice. Maroney is there. He gives it across. Blair into the zone. Buckley is there. It's tipped. Following up on the play, it's picked up by Harmer. Behind the net, tried to roll it in front. Kind of rolled off his stick. Minute 15 on the clock. Saul starting to inch his way out. Here's a chance for McCauley.
Oh, wow.
And it went wide. It was Buckley, rather, 15 that was there that had the chance. Good pressure by the junior wing.
Saul's halfway to the bench. They finally get a whistle, and the faceoff in there to the right of Mullen. That'll take Saul to the bench with a minute and 1 second to go. Both teams at full strength. Sudbury up 2-1.
There's Blair, and it was Buckley. He did get it on the net. Didn't get a whole lot on it. Mullen was sharp. You see Harmer fanned on it as he tried to center it with the backhand pass the first time. Overhead look at it. See that? He didn't get much on it.
He's run off a skate. We got a timeout, I believe. Probably Detroit.
101 on the clock.
Here comes the chalkboard out. Pay attention real close, guys. Here's the way I want to see it done.
Now, Matt Mullen, certainly one of the stars here this afternoon out of Guelph, Ontario. He will turn 20 years of age, Matt Mullen, on November the 9th, so. And we can figure out what
the old chalkboard.
They're telestrating there. A couple of arrows look like just go to the net, boys.
Coaches, boy, they always give you that. Now, if you do it this way, you know, it's got to work. It was so easy to say that, you know. Yeah, you're the guy that doesn't have to go out there and make sure that you do it with other people trying to climb all over your back.
Up next on Passports, Mick, the Lyon Grand Prix Final.
I think that's all they had in my day was the chalkboard. Of course, there was no instant replay and all that kind of stuff.
And don't forget, Junior Red Wing action right back here on Passport. Thursday night, 7 o'clock, as Kitchener will be in town. Saul has gone to the bench. Six attackers on for the junior wing. McCauley and Benedam. Benedam won the draw around the boards. Berard got a skate on it. Now Haggerty trying to tie up Moore. And good job by Moore. He had no place to go with it, so he just eats it along the boards and gets the whistle. The faceoff moves to the other side, and McCauley over to talk to a teammate. Faceoff again, controlled by Sudbury. Fitzpatrick one hands it around the board. Big hit. Puck comes loose. Fitzpatrick gave it away. Harmer drives the shot. Oh, Mullen got a piece of that, and it just squirted wide out the far side, and it's out to center ice for the open net. Moore shot at it, and it's wide. Still a half a minute on the clock. Can the junior wings get control again, though? Shanahan just rolls it back to the corner. Haggerty moves it to Mitchell, back to Haggerty. Quickly ahead for Berard, out of his reach. Sudbury dumps it back into the Detroit zone, 20 seconds on the clock. Long pass.
Oh, he could have played that. That he'll let it go. That's a good call. Nice try by Fitzpatrick.
And Sudbury comes up with it. They roll it down the ice. It's going to miss the open net.
But it's going to be tapped in.
Well, I think the blue light went on first. It will not be a goal for Barry Moore, but it doesn't matter because Sudbury, in a game that's been typical for them, a low-scoring affair, riding the two goals scored by Sean Benedam and the outstanding goaltending of Matt Mullen, Glenn Murkowski's team comes in and gets a hard-earned 2 points as we take a look at the clock winding down. And you'll see the zeros just before. Moore can try to make it a 3-1 final, but it ends up officially 2-1, and we'll be back to wrap it up here at the Joe Louis Arena right after this.